ready when you are.
Alrighty. So, I don't know. Did you want to start by saying something? I mean, we watched About Schmidt. Was there anything that you wanted to say? Because I know this, you'd been thinking about this movie a lot longer than I have.
I guess.
So well, you recommended it. So
I did.
Why?
I recommended it because I just watched it. Actually, you said,
"Oh,
let's talk about a movie." And you've not seen it before, right?
No, this the first time I saw it was when you suggested it.
Yeah, you said, "Let's talk about a movie one of us hasn't seen," and I just seen it again. I watch it about every 2 or 3 years.
Yeah,
and I thought that's a good movie to talk about.
I loved the movie, and apart from loving it, I loved the experience of watching it with my wife because she didn't like it at all.
And it really was, okay, that's really interesting. Because I watched it with some people once who didn't like it.
Oh yeah, why was it for you?
They thought it left them cold. I think.
Oh, that's interesting.
I think so. I think it sort of felt a bit sort of clinical, which I think it does. But I like that.
Yeah, I guess it does. Well, I'll get to that in a minute. But it's one of those movies that makes me stutter when I try to think about and express what I think about it.
We tell people like what it is, sort of like in very literal terms, what it's about? Because that might be challenging in itself.
Why don't you take a stab at it, please?
So spoilers, right?
Yeah.
In a very, very basic way, it's about a fairly elderly man, Warren Schmidt. I think he's 66. His wife dies whilst his daughter is preparing to get married. And the film essentially follows his journey from grieving to going to his daughter's wedding, which he doesn't really approve of, and sort of accepting it, all whilst writing to a six-year-old Tanzanian boy who he sponsored but has never met. And he communicates to this boy one way via rambling letters. Is that accurate?
That's very accurate. I think it gives a much better description than what I would have said, because if I had been asked to summarize the movie, I think I would have only said existential dread.
With a sort of, you know, sort of hipster, proto-hipster, before hipster was a thing, soundtrack. Sort of.
I love the soundtrack. First of all, I wanted to say, I don't know if you had this experience, but I was looking for this movie, and it's not hosted by a lot of services. I think the two that offered it were Amazon and Redbox, and in both cases, they wanted you to buy it in order to watch it.
Is Redbox a thing still?
Oh, Redbox is now a streaming service.
Right. Well, it has to be.
Just like Netflix, right? I think you can still get Redbox kiosks in the store. It's been a while since I've walked into a store. But
okay. La-dee-da.
No, it's not that. I'm really
probably available on public transport.
No, no, no. You have to understand. Like, look at me, man. I'm about that far away from Ted Kaczynski. I'm just hole away in a cave, and I'm pretty happy. But
I also
do not like
stores. Stores are boring.
But I think they have them there. But we just got the service because they've got a broad selection of rent this, rent that.
Yeah.
But in both cases, they want you to buy it so you can watch it. I don't want to buy just the digital thing. I want the physical media. So I bought the DVD from Amazon and had it sent to my house. And it's been so long since I've purchased a DVD and held it. I was getting silly about it, like somebody holding an old record pressing.
Yeah.
You know, and I put it in the player and it had like, you know, the deleted scenes and special features. Has that been something you've done recently? It has been so long since I've had like the extra material that comes along with the film. I've been streaming movies now for so long.
I've seen quite a few things. I remember watching quite a lot of the Marvel sort of extras, and I think often they just come immediately after the film. So you'll buy a 2.5-hour film, but the actual length will be 5 hours because they'll just sort of put them on almost like it's a VHS.
Yeah.
You know, one after the other rather than have a menu.
I think what it was just, it's been a long time since I bought a physical copy of a movie.
Yeah.
That I've been inspired to do so. It's like you can pretty much rent it on anything now. So I say, okay, just pay a couple of bucks to watch it now and I don't have to like store the copy. But then getting this movie and putting it into the player, that was an experience that I'd kind of forgotten that I enjoyed. Just being able to access that stuff. It's weird.
It is weird. And I think the box sort of tells you a bit about things as well. You know, if you look at you look at a box for, not to take you back to Star Wars, but a movie from the 70s that was packaged then and a movie from the 70s that was packaged now, even though it's the same movie, they're often very different. And that tells you something. But with About Schmidt, I remember buying it from Amazon, buying a physical copy from Amazon about 12 years ago. And it cost me something like $2.99 to buy. And I bet you can't buy it from Amazon for $2.99 now.
I have no idea.
You don't even look at the price.
Well, I'm going to sound like an old crotchety bastard. No, what it is really is that my wife knows all the accounts and all the passwords and everything, and I can't keep track of all that crap. So I kind of, I'm going to sound like a very kept man. I go to her and I say, baby, can I get this? And she goes, oh yeah. And she clicks a button and it shows up at the house later. I'm not good for much, George. I'm good for very little. In fact, they wheel me out to my job and they set me in a lab and then I can go do those things. But then at the end of the day, they shut me off and send me home.
Sort of like a Doctor Strangelove sort of character.
More like if you'd ever seen Woody Allen's Sleeper or Sleepers, the little droids that go shuffling across the house servants.
You got room in there for another head change?
Yeah, sure.
All right, I'll be back in a little while.
Let's go.
I haven't seen it for a long time. If I see it,
it seemed really satirical. It was he had been frozen, and then he woke up in the distant future, and the entire society had just gone. It had run amok. It was pretty good. It was like a Rip Van Winkle type story.
I sort of stopped watching his stuff after the Larry David film. I can't remember which one that was.
I couldn't tell you when, but we've gone off track. Sorry.
That's all right.
So yeah, that was the first thing I wrote on here was the DVD experience is awesome because I guess I was having fun watching it. So I don't know. I kind of started at the deleted scenes. I watched the movie once just to enjoy it. And then, I watched it a second time to really like analyze and pick it apart. Mm-hmm. But, what I noticed was, my wife, she didn't like it. And it seems she didn't like it because she was having a hard time liking Warren Schmidt. And I kind of noticed that myself watching it. It seems like, the director, he had a very precise nature in making this film. He was always showing, Schmidt in two lights. You know, he would show him in a good light and then a bad light. And it seemed like he was very careful to keep those instances balanced throughout the story. So there's not really any point where you really start looking at him favorably, but there's not any point where you look at him like he's a completely lost and despicable person. It's like he seems to ride that line through the middle.
Yes.
Hopefully you know what I'm saying.
I do agree. But is that the only reason she didn't like it?
I think so. In her case, yeah. If there's not something in the main character that she can identify with quickly, she tends to struggle to. It's. I think she just didn't find him a very sympathetic character, and I did. She watched him sort of take his wife for granted, and that was kind of a cardinal sin for her, I think. And it kind of was for me too, watching the film. But I think the portrayal of the characters were a little off enough that she didn't quite know how to take it. And that sounds like a really snobbish asshole way to say it, but for me, I think what it came down to was the movie rides a really bizarre line between drama and comedy, and it's not quite either. You know, it's this merging, and yeah. I don't know. I think she would like her. I think she likes her parameters in drama and comedy a little bit more well defined. This movie's a little dark.
Yeah, I mean, talking about the DVD cover, I always thought the DVD cover was sort of, I always sort of considered it quite poor, really. It's Jack Nicholson as Warren Schmidt, sort of with a trench coat on, looking quite bedraggled.
Yeah.
And I think that you could have, you know, it's almost like you could have had an extremely dark cover and sold it as a drama, and people wouldn't have realized it was a comedy. I think that having it sort of so, what would the word be? Sort of pastely. It looks like it's going to be a lot more ha 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 than it is. The comedy is not laugh out loud. It's all very like, that's funny, but also very sad.
You know, that's right. The cover almost looks like it's going to be a road trip boner comedy.
Yeah, and the road trip doesn't even start. I mean, the road trip's only about 20% of it. It doesn't even start until just after halfway through.
Well, the road trip is very subdued as well.
Very subdued.
You know what I loved about the movie was that in any of the scenes where he's riding to Ndugu, the tone or the feeling, the flavor of the movie shifts instantly. And it goes from more of a slow drama to a very punchy, it's almost like watching Napoleon Dynamite. I kept feeling in portions the film just took on a very surreal bent.
I am 66 years old and recently retired as assistant vice president and actuary at Woodman of the World Insurance Company. And God damn it, if they didn't replace me with some kid who, all right, so maybe he's got a little theory under his belt and can plug a few numbers into a computer, but I could tell right off that he doesn't know a damn thing about genuine real-world risk assessment.
Yeah, I think that the style is, it's interesting because, obviously, are you familiar with Alexander Payne?
I'm starting to become more familiar. I've seen, I'd heard of the other movies that he'd done. After I saw this movie, I looked him up and I wanted to see what else he'd been working on.
Yeah, I think famously, his most famous films are probably Election, The Descent, maybe not The Descendants, that was 2011, so that was Sideways.
Sideways, yeah, that's what I was going to mention. I remember Sideways being very widely talked about when it was out.
Yeah, and I haven't seen all of his films, but I've seen quite a few, and there's a lot of recurring themes, but this one, you know, when you talk about style, I think this one, it came out in 2002, and I think you could have made this film at any time, but I think exactly the way it looks and feels is very much of that era.
Yes, and it works perfectly, too.
Yeah, and not so much where it's, you know, like a 70s film where everyone's wearing flares and has afros. It's not, you know, too extreme.
Right.
But it's got that flavor, and it informs it a lot, because I think that flavor's there where it's not in some of his other films.
Well, it has a really mid-American dreariness, too. I mean, everything, that was something that I was appreciating about this guy. Every choice that they made and how they chose to show his environment, you know, like right in the start, you've got it where they frame the building that he works at. What was the name of that? I don't remember the name of his company anymore.
The Woodman's Building.
Yeah, Woodman, right. And they got these very precise angles of it at a very sharp time. You know, it's corner, center, and it's just dominating over you.
Yes.
And I was just looking at that building, and all I could think of was the Crimson Permanent Assurance. Like, it was that kind of satire for me when I saw it. I was laughing hysterically when I saw how they framed it, and my wife looked at me like I was nuts.
Yeah, I think in the DVD special features as well, they've done a number of, I mean, tell me if I'm right. They did a number of different sort of cuts of that building.
Yes.
And one of them has like organ music over it, and it's like, yeah, like Dracula's castle sort of thing.
I think when I saw the movie, I really, I don't want to say I fell in love with the guy's style, But I was really intrigued with it. And then it was after, when I saw the special features on the DVD with the deleted scenes and his explanation of the scenes and, mm-hmm. and why they'd chosen to withhold them and so forth. And I really started respecting the guy as a writer mm-hmm. when I saw that material. I mean, it's clear that he was thinking very carefully about what they were doing in the movie and how pacing was affecting things. And the second time through watching the film, I kind of figured out that I was watching like somebody's masterwork. It was really good.
Yeah, I mean, that's my opinion of this. I mean, if you want me to sort of tell you sort of my relationship with this film, I think this is one of the first...
I'd love to hear it.
This is one of the first films, certainly one of the first modern films, that I ever saw where I could recognize intentionality. And I don't mean recognize as in, like, I could see a bit, you know, Warren looks out of the window, there's someone taking the trash out. I'm not saying I know what that means, but I could recognize that it means something. It's there for a reason. Because I saw it when I was about 14. And it sort of, I think it was one of those films that really got me interested in film. And I've not seen all of his work, so it's not really fair to say, but I do think that this is Payne's masterpiece. I think it's sort of as close to anthropology as he ever comes.
Wow.
And it's so nuanced. And you're right, like, Schmidt is not a nice guy, but he is. But he's a yes. snob, but he's selfish, but he's not unkind.
I think that's kind of when that character solidified for me, because I was taking notes about him, just noting down his behaviors through the film, and I can't remember where it was that I had this thought, but I wrote down, has Schmidt ever had an unselfish thought or feeling? And then I had to really consider, like, going back through the story, each event that happens to him, the decisions he makes and the way he interacts with people, I have to keep asking myself, is he acting this way out of selfishness, or does he have the other person's interests at heart? Because it seems to be that every time some event happens, he's always processing it through how it's going to affect him. That seems to be how he processes his wife's death. He seems more broken up by the fact that she's not going to be there to distract him from his own misery anymore. You know, it feels like he's a very miserable person.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's so much to say about him. He's, you know, there's many ways to look at him. You know, you can talk about so many different things. You can talk about just how, you know, I think later we should talk about class. Because it's so important to this, and I think a lot of other Payne's work.
I see what you mean. Yeah,
but he's sort of like an overachiever who never overachieved, and he's so frustrated by that, and also frustrated by the fact that everyone else seems content not to overachieve. He explains how he was ambitious, mm-hmm. and he blames his wife for him not following through on that ambition, and. And in many ways, I can sort of sympathize with him wanting more and being frustrated with other people not wanting more. But then, I don't know. I mean, he's so lost in a way. He's sort of like someone who never had... He needed a midlife crisis and he never had it, sort of thing.
Yeah, I think that was what the most intriguing thing was for me about him. I just spent the whole movie thinking, what broke him? What was it and when was it exactly? Because the way he was behaving, it was not, to me, it was not characteristic of somebody who had been worn down slowly over his life and then had a breaking point right at the end. His selfishness and ego and self-regard seemed really out. It almost seemed delusional. In certain points, you know, at no point could he just be honest with himself about anything. You know, it was really interesting to watch.
Well, give us an example. Where do you think he's especially delusional?
Well, it's the way he's presenting himself when he writes to Undugu, that it almost seems as though he's moving into a stylized world of his version of events. And you know, he'll what is it? There's the point where he's decided that he's now too miserable on his own, and he needs to go get distracted somewhere else. You hear the kind of language I'm using here. It's like there's a certain interpretation I'm putting on this character, which may or may not be right, you know. And another reason why I love the movie is because I don't know if I'm right about this guy. I have a suspicion, but it's never quite confirmed for me. But he's calling his daughter and saying, "Hey, I got a great idea. I'm going to come down and just be with you, and you can completely upend and reorganize your life to entertain me." And then he's just perplexed when she's not interested in that at all.
You're coming now?
Don't tell me you couldn't use a little extra help with all those wedding arrangements.
And then in the very next scene, he's writing to Ndugu and saying, "Well, my daughter was asking me to come ahead early and help her with a wedding, but I've got places to go and things to see." And it's like, man.
I don't think that's delusional, though. I think that's just his spin on it.
Yeah, well, yeah, maybe that's correct. But it seems like there's points where he's blaming externally, like other people, for problems that he's probably inflicted on himself.
Yeah.
You know, do you know what I mean?
I do. It's... Well, he has this relationship with his daughter that I think is entirely his fault. He's never, you know, it's sort of said at some point by, I think she says, "You never cared about me before." But that's the only time they ever really speak about it. It's all implied.
Well, that's one of the reasons I respected the director so much. Did you watch the deleted scenes for this thing?
Not this time around, but I have watched them, yeah.
So there was one deleted scene
on the toilet.
there was a deleted scene where they had set that up between him and his daughter earlier in the film, far earlier. It was just after his wife had died. They're sitting together on the bed, and he's trying to have a memory with her, and he's telling her, you know, "Do you remember when I took you out for your horseback riding practice or whatever?"
Mm-hmm. "And I take you to riding lessons at Ponca."
"No, that was Mom. Mom always took me horseback riding."
"Are you sure? Because I distinctly remember taking you to horseback riding lessons."
"I don't think so."
And it was this memory that he seemed to have formed in his head and wholly believed in. And she had to tell him, "No, you never took me to do that. That was Mom. Mom always took me horseback riding."
Okay.
He goes, "Well, no, I'm sure I took you at least more than once. I took you a few times." And she's like, "I don't remember, bud. You know what? It must have been a couple of times, and I was just so young I couldn't remember." And she kind of gives it to him. And then you can see it's like really messing with him. Like, why am I remembering this incorrectly?
Yeah.
So the explanation for not putting that in the movie was because the director said, "We were worried it was affecting pacing and slowing down the beginning." And he said that any time that we were spending here in the beginning and not getting him on the road was this price we were paying. We were in danger of completely screwing up the tone of this film. So we opted to take this out, though there was more clarity in this scene, and use this other one as an aside later. So he had this scene that I thought had more subtlety. The idea that he had this incorrect memory of them together, that's really subtle, and it gives you something to really think about, versus when the daughter just says, "Now you want to have an opinion in my life," and that's, you know, that's very in your face, on the nose. But I respected that he took out the subtlety in the beginning so that he could have pacing, so that he could have time and do more with less, really.
I think it works better without it, because the one of the key parts for me is when he's on the phone, the payphone, and he says, "I'm halfway there. By the way, I'm coming to stay to stay at the house you live in with your fiance and his family." I that's what I gather. Yeah. I'm just coming to these people's house to stay for 2 weeks, and she says, "No, Dad," and you get straight away why she's like it. And again, you can look at it from his perspective. Yeah. You know, his wife has just died. He's got no one. But also, you can tell that she's not just annoyed at him. This is his fault that their relationship is like that.
I think for me, what I'm doing is I'm looking at it from the perspective of a writer, and a lot of writers, especially like me, we tend to overwrite. Like, we want to put as much groundwork as we can to explain a character or relationship. And whenever I see somebody that takes something like that out because they trust that the audience is going to get what they're trying to tell them anyway, I like seeing that. I think a lot of us are in need of more self-restraint sometimes. I'm probably in need of more self-restraint sometimes.
I don't know. I think that writing is sort of half art and half engineering, right? You can be all arty and go on these fantastic journeys, but what's the rule of engineering? Tell me. I bet it's not what I'm thinking. The rule of engineering I was going to say is you strip back as much as you can, but retain function.
Okay. I'll accept that.
and you can always, with About Schmidt, you could have so many different scenes where he interacts with different people and it informs him more and more and more, but you don't need it, I guess, is my point.
No, I think you're absolutely right. I think that what impressed me was really just that I don't know that I would have seen that the same way. I think it was right to keep it out and explain it later and preserve pacing. Mm-hmm. And I'm watching this from the perspective of trying to tell the story myself. And I don't know that I would have had the wisdom to omit that scene. I think I might have tried to ram it in there. I'm impressed with the guy. It's pretty good.
Yeah. But don't forget that they omitted the scene after they filmed it. So maybe it only became apparent in editing after, 10 people had seen it.
I'm sure. But, that's really the redrafting process, isn't it?
Yeah, but I don't think that most writers can get as many. I mean, obviously, this is a multi-million pound film. It's different. But I imagine it wasn't just him sort of. No, he was making the decisions. But, you've always got people around you in something like that. I don't know.
Well, yeah, it's got to be more collaborative. And, just listening reading his description of the deleted scene and why they decided to remove them and what the reasoning was. It was always from the perspective of we felt that this was lacking or this needed to come out. So it sounded like he was working with a creative group of people to come up with what they did.
I agree. I'm just looking. What do you want to talk about now? I mean, if you've got more to say about that, but
no, that's fine. We can keep going, or move on to things that you want to cover.
No,
I could go over this thing all night long, but I kind of feel like I should bow to where you want to take this. I'll just get scatterbrained. Can I ask you that there was his retirement dinner?
I thought that was wonderful.
Right at the beginning, it felt to me like, Ray is giving that speech. He's telling him how none of this matters, and that camera's pulling in on his face, and he it looks like he starts from a pretty satisfied state, and then you just see that drop off of him, and I wonder if that's the point where he's finally come to realize that he's basically squandered what he thought his life should have been. Like, was it that moment, or was that just like the straw that broke his back?
But I think you can even argue there that maybe he never realizes that, and maybe what he realizes there isn't that he's wasted his life, but that, wasted it or not, it's over. He's got no job now. He's just sort of waiting to die.
Yeah, I think that's a piece of it. Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I love the bit where Ray stands up and he starts speaking, and the first thing he says is, "All of this doesn't mean a damn." And he's ever so slightly aggressive because he's going into, "It doesn't mean a damn because you've got great friends." But just for a second, it almost sounds like he's going to go off on one. And his wife grabs his hand and he moves it away. And I think that tells you almost everything about where this film is going.
Yeah, it did. I remember watching that scene on the edge of my seat, just watching what Nicholson was doing. I had heard people, because you said, "Oh, let's watch this." So I read a few things about the movie that I could find, and I had heard how people had said this was probably his best. And I thought, oh, please, come on. Because, you know, I'd seen One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, and I was convinced that was his best.
Mm.
But damn, this may have been his best.
I think it's his best. I mean, I think it's his best in his Last Detail. But
well, yeah, it's crazy. It's so, it's very un-Jack Nicholson. Well, maybe that's not right. He's had a very broad range over his career. I don't know why I've got this image of him as kind of more of like a hard ass type or a hard man.
Well, I guess he was, when he was doing Chinatown, he was, the sort of much more of a hero.
Yeah. It felt like he was, it felt like a role that I'd never seen out of him before. It was pretty impressive for me to watch because, for me, there's actors, and I used to think that he was kind of one of them where you never forget that you're watching that actor.
So it's more about the charisma than it is about the
character. Like you never forget you're watching Al Pacino. You never forget that's Joe Pesci or Robert De Niro on the screen.
Steve McQueen hasn't adopted a really convincing Irish accent, and
exactly right. Yeah. Like Robert De Niro, whatever movie he does, he's always gonna do the face thing. But I was
really... just really different, just in one film. Like he brought it out for one film. That'd be so weird.
So, I had kind of lumped Jack Nicholson into that role because he has his own mannerisms and his own visual language that he uses when he's portraying a role. He's got his bounce that he does, but I forgot I was watching Nicholson in this movie. And
that was good.
That's impressive. That's like Daniel Day-Lewis levels of awesomeness. Not to get too technical, but.
Getting a bit of Olivia there. Yeah, I know what you mean.
So you said you saw this at 14.
I think I saw it the first time it was on British TV. It came out in 2002, so I think it could have screened in 2003.
Okay, yeah. I wonder if your take on the movie is very much different from mine, because I saw it at a later age, and... The movie resonated with me in a lot of ways.
The movie,
That has to do on that subject. And, the first time I watched it, what I was thinking to myself was, wow, I really love this. I don't know if I'll ever sit down and watch this again. Because there are parts of it, for me personally, that it's kind of hard to watch.
I find it very difficult to watch.
It's... I could feel there was a lot of tension in the first half of the movie, and thank God the second half was as lighthearted as it was, because I really needed that when it got to that point.
Yes.
That first half, man, I felt like a winding guitar string watching this guy. It was pretty amazing, I thought. And it got me thinking about, a lot of the things that character was thinking about, right? Because now being 41, there's things that are getting taken away. They're not being given to me anymore. You start losing your hair, you start losing your eyesight, your beard starts going gray.
Started losing my hair at 23.
Well, at least you had a chance to get used to it. I was in my 20s too, though. It was towards my late 20s when it started falling out, and that coincided with the birth of my son. So,
right,
I'm sure they're tightly coupled.
Yeah, stress maybe, I don't know.
Sorry. Yeah, plenty of stress being a father. But
I'm not bald, I'm just blonde.
Well, I'm just super bold.
It resonated with me as well, and I know what you mean, because
same reasons?
It's about an old man. It doesn't seem to have mass appeal. An old man who's, suffering from something that I think probably a lot of old people, maybe all old people, go through, but very few communicate, and the media does not take an interest in old people's issues. I think a lot of old people become really depressed when they're old, because they've realized there's nothing I can do. Death is soon. And
I think there's a fear that sets in.
And I think that's quite common, and this really addressed it, and I connected with it on a sort of, on that level, sort of.
Yeah.
You know, because I realized that, you know, as a younger man, I realized that the person who made this wasn't Warren Schmidt. You know, they weren't necessarily saying, woe is me. I thought it was more of like a attempt at a fair look at a certain section of society and a certain thing that they go through.
I think that the director was probably working through some of his own issues making the movie too.
Yeah, maybe. I'm not sure.
I wonder, just because that's a recurring theme in his stuff too. It's always like middle to later aged men towards the end of their life, and now they're trying to deal with, okay, well, what's my meaning now? What is it that's supposed to mean anything to me?
Yes, and it's not just that. It's middle to later aged men who are also middle to upper middle class.
Yes, where it's like you've you know, I was thinking about that with Schmidt, because the movie
is... He's the richest person we meet.
Well, the movie's presented from this perspective that he's really got sort of a dreary existence. I mean, when you look inside his office, it's like this. It looks like... God, I don't even know how to describe it. The design for that set was perfect. It looked like Gray Death. In his office, that was all I could think of, everything in that movie had that flat kind of... It's just gray. Thinking about that movie, assigning a color to it, it's like gray or bluish, and he has that outlook. You can hear it later on when he starts talking about being in risk assessment, and he almost gets a look on his face like he knows how ridiculous that sounds. Like, I can't believe I've spent my entire life just doing that, you know. He had a good job. He had a really good job when you think about it. I think he was a vice president or assistant vice president. He had run a team of people. He had a respectful position.
Yeah, he had a corner office at the top of this building.
Yeah, he had a profession that a lot of people would kill for.
Yeah.
And you see him taking his wife for granted and not appreciating her. And I remember, like, in the notes that I was taking when I was watching this, I was writing down whenever I thought Schmidt was being a dumbass, and
all the time.
Well, there were times where it's like he was really sympathetic, mm-hmm. but there was the scene where his wife drags him out of the house to go have lunch with her in the Winnebago, and I thought she was adorable. She was the sweetest thing I'd ever seen. Like, I think she sensed that her husband was kind of depressed because he'd retired from work, and she was doing things to like try to spice him up. She was doing things for him because she cared about him.
Yeah.
And I rarely saw him do a damn thing for anybody in this movie because he was concerned about how they felt. And I thought, you fool, you're wasting this woman. She's so good to you.
Yeah. And his child as well.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I hadn't figured that out at that point.
No. I know what you mean. Yeah. Things become clear as they go along. Have you heard of the principles of scientific management?
God.
Do you read a lot of literature from the 1910s? Go on.
It sounds like one of the self-help management books that everybody in my professional circle tends to read, and the prospect of reading it makes me want to throw myself out a window.
Oh, really? Who do they read? Do they read Tony Robbins?
You know, probably. All right.
Okay.
I don't pay a lot of attention to the new authors, but there's always, you know, there's always like a new book, and it's like, oh, it's this new management style, or it's this leadership style.
Shit yourself rich.
Yeah. Or they want to have we're going to have some team building thing, right?
Oh, right, I see.
And or there's a new project management methodology that everybody else is using, and quick, lets us use it too, because it's the magic bullet that's going to fix all our problems. And when you do anything for long enough, and especially when it has to do with management or leadership of people, all the new things that they dream up all the time, it's just noise. It's new names to apply to the same concepts over and over again. It's like every time a new diet fad comes out. By the way, this is how you're gonna lose. Yeah, this is how you're gonna lose weight this time. You're gonna eat only Smarties and Tootsie Rolls, and it's the kill yourself diet. I don't know, but I'm not interested in those books, and it's probably a blind spot for me. But
okay, the Principles of Scientific Management was a monograph published by Frederick Winslow Taylor in 1911.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And in it, he describes, and you can look this up on Wikipedia, and it's almost all there. He describes Schmidt, and Schmidt is the perfect worker. And he based Schmidt on a real person. And what he did was, Schmidt was someone who, he was a manual laborer, as I understand it, and he averaged moving about 12 tons of pig iron a day.
Oh, wow.
And Frederick Winslow Taylor proved, or tried to prove, or said he proved, a better way of managing people by taking this guy, and I think he worked with him for about 3 years, and he sort of put him through this rigorous mode of working where everything was directed. So he wouldn't just do things himself with a quota. It would be stand up, pick up the pig iron, take the pig iron over there, put it down, have a rest, stand up, do it twice, and then you can have another rest. Okay, take lunch now, stand up. He did it. Was all like that. And
oh my God.
He actually did a lot more work, and he was paid more. He was paid, I think it's 60% more.
Mm-hmm.
And Schmidt, in that sort of language, or that sort of area, the sort of business area, is the perfect worker. He's someone who's motivated by money, who will take direction, and who will work a lot harder for a little bit more money. And I wonder how much that fits into this film, because I don't think it is just a coincidence.
No. Don't you wish you could ask him?
Don't you wish you could ask him, yeah. But maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah, that's a good point, yeah.
I mean, you know, if it did or didn't, I still like it.
I do very much. I'm listening to you describe that style of work, and I know there are people who probably subscribe. Even
well, it
today.
Was 109 years ago, so
I know, but I there's still people who are like that. They like to get their hooks into every little thing their worker does, and it sounds like a crushing, debilitating way to exist.
Well, I'm not sure if it was still being taught in business degrees, but I know it was definitely mentioned in business degrees.
I get that. Like you're the example, or what they did in that book is an extreme case. But I mean, you're basically describing the style of micromanagement. In a lot of project management is really about that. It's about trying to take everybody and turn them into performance characteristics, performance cogs, and make them predictable.
But I think the important thing about the comparison, though, is it wasn't just the micromanagement that I think, if Alexander Payne took anything from the Principles of Scientific Management, I don't think it was just about that. I think it's that Schmidt, the perfect worker, was sort of greedy, pretty complacent, pretty happy to take direction, and not necessarily very intelligent.
Mm.
I think he even says in this thing, This doesn't work with a skilled technician or something like that.
Jeez.
So I don't know. Maybe it's just a coincidence. But
well, no, I don't. It's like I said. I don't think it's a coincidence. I think it lines up very well. I wonder if Schmidt, the character in the movie, was more motivated more by material compensation or status. It seemed like status played a bigger role in his mind, in his estimation of himself, than like cash. He sounds like he's a penny pincher. Like he's
a penny pincher. Yeah.
You know, he's always complaining about the expense and so forth. But like inextricably tied to that is this concept of status. Like he's always looking down on people that he doesn't perceive to be at his level or his station in life.
Yeah, he penny pinches everywhere. He didn't want to buy the Winnebago. He asks if he can drive himself to his own wife's funeral. He gets his wife the second cheapest coffin the cheapest apparently being a pine box.
That's right.
You know, he doesn't want to, you know, spend money. But the only time he spends more money than he needs to is to give to Ndugu.
Yeah, that's, well, I think that's his one. If you want to be really judgmental on the character, and I find myself doing that sometimes. I'm falling into that trap where I'm just looking at it and going, you dipshit.
Well, you can do that for a minute.
It's hard to stay there. Because he ends up being sympathetic again just a few minutes later. It's that excellent balance that the director achieves in the movie.
When he's talking to this 6-year-old child and he says, by the way, I put a little bit more money in this month, so expect you want to go down to the bank and cash that check.
I know. He's completely clueless with the way he talks to the kid. Like when he says, one day when you go to college, I recommend that you pledge to a fraternity as well. It's like, you know, I don't want to presume as though the kid's never going to have a chance to escape his situation.
No, but he's an
he's in a rough spot right now. He's probably not thinking about Harvard right now, buddy.
So, I recommend Yale. I'm a Yale man. He writes. I mean, he is very naive. You know, he's got the bit on the road trip where he says, "And I was talking to a Native American gentleman. He was telling me all about their history, and they just got a raw deal."
It was just this guy working in a 7-Eleven, and he's standing there behind the counter talking to him as though he's
a lonely guy.
Yeah, I think there's so much happening in this movie. It's so hard to land on any one thought. The other thing that I like is he makes an ass of himself when he's looking down on other people and just, you know, looking down his nose at him.
Yeah, but he's a snob.
Then at the same time, a lot of the time he's right.
Yes. Absolutely. And this is why it's nuanced. Because
the son-in-law is such a goon. that's one of the notes I have here. Yeah, at the top of this page. Dermot Mulroney is the best ever.
the way he walks, even.
Oh God, yeah. He's got this posture. It's the perfect way to stand to make that ponytail on the back of his head look as stupid as possible. It's amazing.
The fellow's name is Randall Herzl. He's got a sales job of some sort. Maybe Jeannie is a little past her prime, but I still think she could have done a heck of a lot better.
How you guys doing?
I mean, this guy's just not up to snuff, if you ask me. I mean, not for my little girl.
Yes, it's fascinating. There's so much to talk about there because, okay, so really at the end of the film, he doesn't approve of his daughter's wedding. His daughter gets married anyway, and then he goes home. And he says when he comes through the door, now my daughter is married to that nincompoop. And I think that's the perfect word for Randall. I think it's probably the perfect word for how Schmidt feels about him, because he's not a bad person.
No,
he's not malicious in any way. He's just a bit of a fool.
Yeah.
But he's not bad.
Like for me, the only way I could really hold any malice towards that guy from the position of a father-in-law is just, you know, don't lose your earnings in a stupid scheme and make my daughter destitute, please. Don't, you know, I'd almost want to like own a business and then give him a job there so I could keep an eye on him and make sure he doesn't fuck my kid's life up too much. I could see being concerned about him from that point, but what was interesting to me is Schmidt never had that moment of growth or clarity. He never got to the point where he realized my daughter is an autonomous human and she's now at the point of her life where she gets to decide. He comes home and says, I couldn't break up the marriage. I am a failure. And it's like, man, that's not something you're supposed to succeed at, you idiot. Yeah. It's like he never learns.
He never learns. It's a completely non-traditional arc where things do happen and change, but he doesn't really change that much.
Yeah, I think the person who changes the most through this whole thing is the audience, really.
Yeah.
You know, I felt very, God, I don't know. I rarely watch movies that I come out of feeling both so down and also laughing my ass off. you know, at the same time. It's a very strange emotion to experience.
When, I mean, with Randall and his reaction to him and, you know, his whole selfishness, it's selfish, but at the time, it's so, I find myself sympathizing a lot.
Oh, him. Yeah, yeah, when, it's totally understandable.
Yeah, because obviously you don't want your daughter to get married to this guy. You're telling her a day, 2 days before she gets married that you feel this way. Yeah. You knobhead. But also, your wife dies, your daughter comes to stay with you for a few days. She brings this guy who you don't really like, but whatever. And then a day after that happens, he comes in to your study and he pitches you a pyramid scheme. Like 2 days after your wife is dead, I can sort of understand why it's like, what are you doing? What are you doing with these people? These people are stupid. I sort of get it.
Well, that I kind of wonder, is Randall just someone that the daughter is inflicting on her father? Like, is this punishment?
I don't think so.
I don't think she's doing that. I think she's probably enough of a goofball herself that she can't see it.
Well,
but...
Yeah, but also, right, I mean, tell me if I'm wrong. I don't mean to sound mean here, but I think that what they do with her is they set it up quite cleverly with Hope Davis, who I think is really great. But, you know, he describes her as, you know, that guy, Randall, he isn't up to snuff for my genie and all of this and, you know, how wonderful she is. And actually, mm-hmm. she's a bit past it. She's 66. She's in her mid-30s, right?
Yeah, yeah.
She's even a little bit older than Randall. And she, you know, he says she has so much potential. It sort of kind of sounds like she has a pretty average job in a shipping department.
Yeah.
And I think he's sort of... I don't know if he's over... I'm maybe overestimating her.
I think he puts her up on a pedestal. I think...
But that's just an extension of him.
Yes, I think in a lot of ways that's like the last legacy he has to hold on to.
Absolutely. You know? The children won't have his name.
Yeah, he had that job, which I think he must have thought for a minute, oh, I'm pretty important here. I'm this top rated person. I've got my own team. But then as soon as he leaves, he comes back to see if he can be of use, and the company has entirely moved on.
Yes.
And he sees the sum total of his life's work out in the dumpster in the back when he's coming out of the building. He looks at his wife and finds that he's very dissatisfied with her, though, you know, you dipshit. She's there every day with you. It's like trying to make it work. And it's like you'll watch through this movie as everything is just taken away from him. Everything he thought he had. Even when he had finally decided, you know what, I've been so uncharitable to my wife, and he starts feeling very tender and he's reminiscing, and then he finds out she's been screwing around on him. And not only that, it's with his best friend. So, yeah. You know, even that relationship is taken away from him, right? It's like he loses everything and all he has left is, God damn it, that's my daughter. That's it. You know, and I think that also comes from a place of ego. I think it's coming still from that same selfish place. And I think she's pretty much over it. I think she's just kind of, you know, she's about average. He doesn't, you can't even really say that he knows her that well.
No, he doesn't.
He hasn't had much to do with her. So I think he requires her to be great in his mind because that's about what he's landed on.
Because of course she would be, because, you know, yeah. I had so much potential. And, you know, the reason I didn't follow through on these grand dreams was to raise my daughter. That's what's going on in his head.
Yeah, you know, I wonder if that's something that was taken into account when they were designing that character, or if that was just a statement that the director himself was making on general, like, what living sort of in this system, in this country, will do to you. You know, do you know what I'm saying? It's I wonder if he was trying to make a message, or if this was all just 100% character. It's kind of hard to interpret.
I do know what you mean, because without ever saying it, there is a class thing where he is obviously fairly wealthy, definitely wealthier than the average person.
Yeah, he's got a very nice house.
And he's got a very nice house, and he has this massive Winnebago and all of this. And
that he paid half.
Yes, and his wife were like had to put all of her savings into it. Yeah.
Yeah, that, you know, that was something my wife picked out when he said that was her money. I couldn't stop it. What, I was going to stop her from spending her money? My wife picked that out, and she goes, oh, he's one of those kind of people. And I, what do you mean, babe? And she says, he's one of those my money kind of people. It's not our house. It's not our, it's mine. This is what I earned. You stay away. And you know, she picks stuff out like that, and I often miss it.
Yeah, he's the one with the purse strings.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He won't even give up a dime when he's talking about how his daughter and new husband are going down to Florida for the honeymoon. He doesn't say they're going on my dime. He says they're going on my nickel. Won't even give up a dime for an expression, man. He's so cheap.
Okay, I never thought of that. That's quite interesting. Yeah. You're going on my dollar, I suppose you could have said. Yeah.
Yeah.
Hmm. Well, when he goes and visits the Herzls, there's a class thing that's unsaid where he's sort of vaguely disgusted by them. And
everything in that community, down to the guy throwing the trash away across the street.
See, again, it was that sort of intentionality that when I first saw it, I was really impressed with. I see sort of what this is about.
I immediately had to think about how did they get that guy to do that? Like, did the director stroll over to that house and say, listen, can you do me a favor?
No, that's a guy they left paid $300 for that day to do.
Yeah.
They'll just come out of the house and do this. They'll have put him in costume and everything. Yep.
Wow.
All those bags will be full of ripped up paper or something. I would be surprised if it was the actual man who lived there.
That's interesting. Yeah, I mean, you've clearly got more insight into that than I do. So.
Well, it had a huge budget. It had about 30 million.
How 30? 30?
Yeah, 30. Yeah.
Wow. Was that all Jack Nicholson's salary? Good lord.
I don't know. I guess probably a bit of it was.
Yeah, it doesn't feel like an expensive movie. I don't want to say that in a disparaging way. I mean, it's a beautifully crafted movie.
Yeah.
But it doesn't feel expensive.
No, there's no, you know, helicopter shot going into the volcano, is there? I know what you mean. I think it's probably a lot to do with, like you said, actors' salaries. And there was a lot of on-location stuff.
Yes.
I suppose. So, you know, could they have made it for 10? Yeah, they could have. I guess they probably could have made it for 1, but...
You
could have also made it for 100.
if you know about
accounting, you know.
Well, it just depends on how many people you can convince to work for free.
Turkish bath.
So.
I was going to ask as well. His daughter lives in that house with her fiance and the mother-in-law, Kathy Burke.
Is that right?
I'm asking you. No, it's not right, is it? Because she does leave.
Yeah, I think they have their own place elsewhere. I think he's just staying with the parents.
The parents who were divorced but still live together. And
well, that's the other thing. I don't even know. See, I kept making those assumptions as I was watching it. And then the second time through, I was looking very closely, and I couldn't even confirm if her ex-husband was living there or he was just coming around for some reason. I mean,
with his new wife. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. His new, oh, I don't remember her name, but yeah.
Sandra.
It just seemed like he was always around there, but he probably didn't live there.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very strange family. I loved the family. I loved Kathy Bates' character. I thought she was awesome. She is exactly the kind of person that I'd like to sit back and have a drink with.
That's interesting as well, because I didn't really like her character.
No.
No.
Well, so there were things about her.
I liked her doing it.
Oh, yeah, you know, she's great in the movie. Well, so here's the thing. There were definitely things about her that were off-putting.
Yeah.
Or not appropriate. She kept winning me over. Just like
Schmidt
kept winning me
over.
You know what I mean? Because when she first invites him into the house, I thought, okay, is she being genuine or is she really this nice? And it seemed like she was really that nice. So right away, that makes her likable for me. And she's sitting back down and, you know, their place is a mess, but I don't have to live there. I don't care if they're going to be slobs. That's on them.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
But she's very friendly. She's very warm, very welcoming. She's at pains to make him at ease. She wants to make him a drink so that they can relax together. And then the next thing you know, she's running into the next room, and it suddenly sounds like Jerry Springer, and she's cursing at this guy and screaming and fucking and kicking him out of the house.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's really that's unlikable. And but then right after that, she's really charming again. And then, you know, the pass that she made at Schmidt was really, really offsides. That probably breaks her for a lot of people, I think.
In the book, he really likes her. I think he fantasizes about her. And she and her husband are both psychiatrists. Have you come across the book? It's not very good.
Okay. So, yeah, I didn't realize that. Okay. So that really makes it quite a different story, though, doesn't it?
Louis Begley, or Louis Begley's 1996 novel. I've read it. I read it more than 10 years ago now, and it's very different. It's really about Warren Schmidt. His wife dies. I think he's actually quite a bit wealthier in the book. Mm-hmm. His daughter is marrying someone who is also from a wealthy family. Like I say, both his parents are psychiatrists. And a lot of the book is about, he has an affair with a young Puerto Rican maid.
Oh, geez.
I think. Yeah, it's very different.
A completely different story.
Yeah,
It's not even the same thing.
No, it's not the same thing. I mean, Alexander Payne wrote the script for this in 1991, which was 5 years before the novel came out. And I don't know what happened, but I get the sense that they probably optioned the novel and really sort of really just took the name and changed a few things around.
Oh, you know what?
Changed quite a few things around.
Yeah, no, that rings a bell, because I was reading about this movie after having watched it, and it was the director had been working on his own story, and I think... Oh God, I'm screwing this all up. I thought that he was having a hard time getting it made, but then somebody had optioned the rights for this book to turn it into a film, and he kind of took the things and bashed them together to tell the thing that he wanted to. I should probably go look that up and clarify that in notes or something.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly see it much more as Payne's story than Begley's. I remember reading about Schmidt, and I remember at the end, they had the first chapter of his next book, and I read it all at once. And it was about that his book after about Schmidt was about a fairly elderly, highly successful businessman who has a single child who is his daughter, and he finds out that she is infertile. So he decides that he's going to have to go and impregnate someone else, so he can pass on his genes. And I remember reading it and sort of going, oh my okay, God. And closing it and just throwing it. Just whatever.
That's enough of that.
Yeah, it's just, oh, okay. I get it, dude.
Yeah, it sounds like the movie was a superior article.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, I would say so. I would say vastly superior, really.
There were points in the movie where I wondered if it was the right decision to make from telling a story. And, you know, obviously it probably was the right decision to make, because that was the choice the director went with and he was saying something. But when Schmidt, I guess he got a bit drunk with the fellow campers.
So he goes on a road trip and he goes to a campsite and he meets these two, a couple who have like a pretty normal sized RV. He has a massive RV. They have a normal RV. Again, you got the class thing a bit.
Yes. I thought that was interesting. I thought it was interesting how...
He goes to their RV.
I like how willing he was to hang out with them.
Well, he's very lonely.
Well, yeah, but that's the thing. Like, they seem like really... They're kind of gooby. They're kind of schlubby.
Yeah, but... Yes. Yeah.
They're very kind.
Yeah.
But they remind me a little bit, you know, and don't... don't assign too much weight to this, but the way they interact, they kind of remind me of his in-laws or his future in-laws, in that they feel like the same kind of people that he would look at and go, if he had people
someone
around
else
to cater
to
him. If he had his wife, he would look at them and go,
no, thank you.
Right? Mm-hmm. But now because he's lonely, like there's this scene where he's sitting around the table and they're, you know, he's doing some silly jokes with them and they're all laughing. And I think it was always, he's got a picture of George Washington in his wallet. And,
he doesn't have a picture of his daughter. He has a picture of George Washington.
Right, right. And they say, oh, you got a picture of Abe Lincoln? And he goes, who's that? And it gets him laughing even harder. And I swear to God, Nicholson flashes a look at one point. And from what I read from that was, he kind of felt like, okay, if it means I don't have to be lonely, I can sit around and tell jokes with these morons.
I can be charming for an evening.
Yes. If it gets me a distraction, if it gets me entertained for a little while, yeah, I guess I can do this. I kind of got that. I don't know if that was the intent, but you know, then the husband takes off for a resupply of beer.
Yep.
And he
God. He flings himself on this poor lady.
I feel dirty just thinking about that scene, man.
I thought it was funny.
She's got nothing for but sympathy for this poor idiot.
And then he lunges at her and kisses her.
And sad man. And yeah, he just goes for it. He goes right in there for a kiss. And when I was watching that, I was thinking, is that too far? Or have you just made him too despicable? I don't know if I can like this guy after this.
Yeah.
I did again later. Like, I kind of forgive him later, but he really seems to push the boundaries sometimes.
But I don't think he's laying on this woman's, or resting on this woman's shoulder with her stroking him and her saying, there. I don't think he's thinking, I could have sex with her. I'm going to have sex with her. I think he just sort of, I think it's more and more sort of like a sudden emotional thing.
Do you think it was spontaneous?
I don't think he would. I don't think he was trying to seduce her.
I don't know. Maybe we read the scene differently.
I'm not sure. It's ambiguous.
It is. That's why I liked it so much. Because there's a point where he gets a very sly look in his eyes when she's talking to him. And she, oh, you're such a sad man. And she reaches out and she starts, you know, she escalates by touching him. And then you see him kind of, you know, he gives her this look like, oh. And I can't tell if it's him thinking,
I'm so sad.
Well, that's it right there. I can't tell if he's thinking, maybe if I play up the sympathy, I can get a pity lay. Or if he's thinking that she's got a genuine romantic interest in him. It's hard for me to draw that distinction between what I get out of him from that scene.
Maybe to really understand his motives, we need to sort of establish where the beer shop is. Like, how long's he got? Because if the guy's coming back in 2 minutes, I mean, it's not a good plan.
Well, you know, I don't know. When you're that advanced age, do you need more time to get the engine running or less? I'm not sure. Like, does the act take longer or shorter? I don't know.
But I mean, you know, if the shop, if the wherever he's getting it from is sort of, you know, just next door.
It seemed like it was very quick. It was
Schmidt,
like
he's a sort of belts and braces sort of guy. It's going to take him 5 minutes to get his pants off. You know, I mean,
and you know, you'd want to make sure that he didn't pull a muscle. He'd probably have to.
Yeah, I can't imagine. You know, it's not going to be a sort of, you know.
Stretches, breathing exercises.
Striptease-esque.
Yeah. He really went for it, though. But, yeah, it's strange because through most of the movie, he seems so straight-laced about sex. You know, he seems very... whenever anybody talks about anything remotely having to do with that area, he gets very uncomfortable. It seems like he doesn't even like to discuss sex with his wife.
When do they discuss it?
They don't. That's the point. She at the start of the movie, she seems like a completely non-sexual being to him. She's just this curiosity that he's sharing his house with now.
Yeah.
And then later, when he's dealing with Kathy Bates, you know, he's visibly unsettled when she refers to her hysterectomy, And I guess that some people would think that's very personal. That's kind of oversharing, but I don't know what kind of interactions they've had before. And, you know, in my family, some people share stuff like that. Like, especially it seems the older you get, the more you hear about people's medical procedures.
Morning. I've had a hysterectomy. What, this morning? Yes, it is a little sort of conservative that he's shocked by that. But she has just been telling him all about her son's and his daughter's sex life.
Yeah. Yes. So, well, it's very clear she is a moonchild hippie. Which, that doesn't, I mean, you can tell that's completely opposed to his ideology. I mean, there's the scene, I think he's got to mail a letter to Ndugu, and he's driving through the town, he's listening to Rush Limbaugh on the car radio. So that kind of places him ideologically for me. He's got the, you know, the conservative Republican, he's probably voted on some sort of marriage protection act at some point, I suppose. And
maybe. Yeah.
He seems like somebody who's got a very narrow worldview.
He's old-fashioned, definitely.
Yes, and I just like that every time there was an opportunity for that to be expanded a little bit in the movie, he would retreat like a frightened turtle.
Yeah, but I can understand, you know, not, you know, he's in the hot tub, and I can understand he reacts the way he does. You know, his wife has just died.
That scene was way out of bounds. For me, it's, you know, like, it's like I said, I enjoyed the mother character. If her son was going to marry my daughter, I don't know how I'd react to it. I don't know how well I'd be able to maintain my sanity through that one.
Yeah, I also think, I know we were mainly talking about story, but I think that scene's a really good example of appropriate on-screen nudity. Because it doesn't seem dwelt upon, and it isn't like necessary so much, you know, in the script. You could hide it, but then I think hiding it would be weird as well. And it just seems very sort of, you know, she takes her clothes off, she gets into the hot tub. You know, we don't get a weird panning shot, but also no one's really embarrassed by it either. It seems quite modern.
I think it's done very matter of fact.
Yes, that's and what I'm saying. Yes,
I think what's wonderful about that is that perfectly frames her attitude to the whole thing, her attitude toward sexuality and nudity and how she sees human interaction in general. She's just it's very common to her. There's nothing shameful or taboo about it. So it makes perfect sense that she'd conduct herself that way.
Yes, but I also think that it sort of shows. It's a good example of the even-handedness you find elsewhere from the director, is what I mean.
Mm.
Yeah. I mean, it does reflect her, but I also mean, I think it reflects the way, sort of the feeling of the film.
Well, everything is very it's presented very flat and matter of fact. It's one of the things that I liked about it. It has. You know, the feel of it. I mentioned Napoleon Dynamite earlier. I'll assume you've seen that.
Yeah.
It's what I was kind of thinking watching the movie was I think the director from that film and the director from this film, they both kind of came up in the same geographic region in America. And I'm wondering if the visual similarity that I saw between the films is because of growing up in that area. And that's just how you like. That whole part of the country, it's like that. It's just pulled back and flat. When you stand out in the middle of it, it feels like it goes on forever.
Mm.
And the shot composition that I was watching in this movie and then other movies that kind of have that same feel, it looks like that. It's you see horizon going on for miles in a lot of scenes, and it's just it makes you feel very small watching it. Or it can also be very humorous if whatever's happening is just presented to you right in that shot, hits you in the face.
Yes.
I have no idea if I'm making sense.
No, you're making complete sense. Yes, I know what you mean. Good. I think it's good utilization of the location, I suppose. Oh, that word reminds me of something I just wanted to get in there because I know you want to bring this back to Star Wars somehow.
What?
Just
never.
A second.
Why would you think that?
This is nothing to do with anything. I just wanted to say, because this will make you smile.
Very well.
The DOP of this film was the location DOP of Return of the Jedi.
Oh, very. That explains the Ewoks.
Yes. What are these doing here? Yeah.
I remember mentioning to you. I sent an email to you that the first time I watched that wedding scene, it made me think of a Neil Breen movie.
Anyone in particular?
No. And now I'm going to struggle to explain myself because I realized in the email, it's like, oh, that almost seems like I'm not appreciating this guy's movie.
This is terrible.
If I'm saying, yeah, and that's really not what I meant. It was that the people who were attending that wedding and the performers.
Oh my God, the wedding singer.
Yes,
that is so funny.
That's exactly what I'm talking about. I don't know how the hell they did it. I don't know if it was intentional from the director or they just found somebody who sang like that. God help us all. But they conveyed a certain lack of self-awareness.
What's more funny
I've
than
only
a trash
ever,
wedding?
Well,
a
yeah,
trash I, wedding that doesn't know it's a trash wedding.
They had to convey on purpose a lack of self-awareness that I'd hitherto only seen in a Neil Breen film. That's the only way I can describe it. It's like when you're watching a Neil Breen film, you watch the actors. I can't tell if anybody in the scene realizes what's happening.
So it's almost
or
like
what this is going to be. You know what I mean?
They're on opposite ends of the spectrum, but the spectrum is a circle. So yes. So that whole scene in About Schmidt is no one knows that this is just laughable, but they do. It's, you know, that's the joke. Whereas Neil Breen stuff, it's no, he's just clueless. That's the joke.
I guess the genius is that in one of the movies it was on purpose.
The genius is one is genius and one is just mind-bogglingly deluded.
I don't know. Breen might be a secret genius.
I saw
footage of him. Oh man, I don't want to talk too badly.
Of him. What in the woods somewhere, and people are like, "That's not Neil Breen. It's a man in Neil Breen suit. Look at the way he's walking."
He'd come out to California for a public speaking event, and they had an auditorium full of Neil Breen fans screaming for this guy when he came out, and I don't want to talk poorly about the guy. It would make me feel bad to do that. But he comes out and people are screaming, and you can hear people in the audience because they're recording on cell phones, and it doesn't sound like any of them are really cheering ironically. It sounds like they're all serious to be out there, and I don't know what's happening. I don't know if that's a room full of. It makes me doubt my understanding of reality.
Yes. With those, though, I mean, as I understand it, he shies away from a lot of stuff because he doesn't like, as I understand it, he doesn't like the reaction to his films, which is, I enjoy watching these because they're really bad.
Yeah, but you know what? Everybody who was there was really nice to him.
Well,
which was cool. It's not like they brought him out and then ambushed him with a bunch of shitty questions, like trying to be an ass and show him up.
What the fuck did really you think you were doing, you dickhead? Well,
yes. You know, if you look at this by contrast, we're getting way off topic here, but Len Kambiziski, if you know who that is.
I do.
He had appeared on Red Letter Media after they shat all over one of his movies, and the guy had... he had the courage to go in there and take it face to face and discuss films. And then he turned it into a discussion where he talked about the struggle of independent filmmaking. I'm sure you've got plenty to say about that.
Well, you know,
I admired him for doing that. I thought that was really cool that he would go in there and just sit down and chat with the people that kind of gave him the business.
Yes. But I think that's something he has that Breen lacks is sincerity.
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, and I think Breen is really probably one of the most narcissistic directors that has ever existed. and I think his level of competence is actually... I mean, it's fascinating that they occur simultaneously. He is very incompetent and he is very narcissistic and insincere. You know, it's fascinating that they appear at the same time, but I think they're independent of each other. Because you get narcissistic directors, Shyamalan, who aren't but, you know, who aren't terrible.
I think that was the distinction. For a Shyamalan movie, I can still look at that and say that's artistic.
He tried. You know, he tried. He believed in it at some point.
Yes, I think his movies oftentimes have dumb elements in them. But yeah. there are other aspects in them that I wouldn't want to discard just because of those dumb elements. He has moments of art and clarity in his movies. It's just a shame that they're jumbled up by all the other stuff. Breen, I don't know what he's doing.
I think to give that to sort of save your faith in humanity when you talk about are people being ironic when they cheer for Breen. I went to a screening of The Disaster Artist. Do you know what that is?
Yes, seen it.
Yes, it's a film about the making of The Room.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to an early screening where Greg Sestero was there. He was there. Greg Sestero, who's...
Yes.
Oh, hi, Mark. He's Mark.
Yeah, the blonde guy.
The blonde guy.
The guy who seems to have been hijacked by a crazy Tommy Wiseau.
He wrote the Disaster Artist book, and then the film was sort of loosely based on that.
Yes.
And, you know, I was there, and I remember I went to see The Room when it used to play in London at this theatre called the Prince Charles Theatre, which is in central London, and it's pretty famous for being one of the sort of few well-known central London locations that plays all these art house movies, or really, you know, it'll play Alien. All the Alien movies back to back for a week, and they would have screenings of The Room, and everyone would throw spoons at the screen, right, and shout at the screen, and it was a lot of fun. But anyway, I went to see the Disaster Artist presented by Greg Sestero, and everyone there was sort of really, you know, really excited, and everyone there was really nice to him, and I think it just attracts the sort of dork. I think, you know, the bad movies that are so bad they're entertaining, I think it just attracts the sort of dork that isn't, you know, nasty. It isn't someone who takes films so seriously they have to say, you're rubbish.
I think that must be what it is. Because you're basically describing the reaction I have to those movies. I love, if it's really... bad, good, or good, bad, or whatever you want to call it. When it's really there, I love those movies, and I love that they get to exist. And yeah, I wouldn't want to. If I met the guy who made it, I wouldn't want to really crap on it because I would want him to go make more. I enjoy that stuff. I think it's fun.
Yeah, and I think just most people don't want to meet someone and, you know, crap on them like right there to their face. And who wants to get into that?
No, yeah, well, I mean, I wouldn't even want to do it online. I know a lot of people feel empowered to do that. I see people reaching out to other creators and just telling them they are all the time. And I don't understand that. I don't understand the desire to do that. Like, I'll make a commentary video and talk about what they messed up in a movie.
But it's not for that person to see.
That's about as far as I take it. I'm always trying to take it from a perspective of, you know, let's talk about story and what works and what doesn't and why. And I don't really want to get into attacking people. I'll drop the odd joke just because it has to stay entertaining. But I, you know. I've heard people say horrible things about Shyamalan or some of the other directors. And it's like, man, the guy just tried to make you a thing to watch. You know?
Yeah, and there is a difference. There is a difference between talking about someone's work and them. I mean, I don't know anything about M. Night Shyamalan, and I don't really want to. I know that a lot of people do enjoy... I tried to do this series where I was going to go through all of Kubrick's films, and I realized that to do it properly, I would need to read a lot about Kubrick, and I didn't really want to. Sometimes I find that when you read about people, it doesn't actually enrich your experience of the art.
Well, or it demystifies them.
Sort of, yeah. And I'm much more interested in the art than the person behind it usually. And, you know, Neil Breen is an obvious sort of exception because... well, he's the actor, he's the director, he's everything. The art is him. And, you know, he could be a lovely man. I'm sure he's a lovely man. I'm sure he's a very clever man because you can't be in a place where you can fund your own 50 grand movie without being intelligent.
Well, I understand he's a pretty successful architect in Vegas. So, I mean, good on him.
I think there's a little debate about whether he's an architect or a realtor.
Oh. Okay.
Yes.
Well, don't believe everything you read on the internet then, I guess. Okay.
Well, I don't know. I don't know. Maybe the images were doctored of the Las Vegas bus stop with his face on it with a realtor ad next to it.
No,
could have been. No, but it could be fake. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know, but
he's such a surreal character though. I would love for there to be a reality show about Neil Breen where they just follow him around making his movie. I think it's as fascinating as a Bob Lazar interview.
Yeah, but it's like the making of, but it's directed by Werner Herzog. And it's like, it wasn't until we started filming Act 2 that we realized
be so great.
Neil hadn't realized the humorous element in his own film. That's more Austrian, I guess.
We see a man who is broken and has no idea what he's doing. I would love that. God, I love Herzog's film so much, too. He could do something amazing with that.
Yes. But just to finish our discussion on Neil Breen.
We've gone off the rails again.
Yeah, well,
we?
We'll go back to about Shemet. It's film.
Yeah, that's good. It'll be there when we get back.
Yeah, on my podcast, which sort of part of the joke was that it's terrible, and we never talk about the subject.
Oh fuck! You know what? I had a black light that I wanted to shine at you. I don't know where it is right now, though. I got a black light. That seems to be a recurring bit on the podcast.
What, the black light?
Well, as it relates to a specific type of cookbook that seems to frequently get brought up.
I see. I remember very little of the podcast.
Well,
just so you know.
It sounded like you guys really just took off in random directions. Now there was a cookbook that was it was all about ejaculate and using that as a recipe in various dishes. You guys were talking about that in a few episodes, and
doesn't sound like me.
No.
don't know what you're talking about.
Okay, we can cut this out. That's fine.
Well, but in that horrible podcast, I stopped. You know, I put it on hiatus because I started to produce my own film, I put it on hiatus. And I was going to do 3 episodes, and I only did 2. And I recorded the last one, and the last one was on Twisted Pair, which is Neil Breen's latest film, where he plays twins, one of which is Neil Breen and one of which is Neil Breen with a mustache sellotaped to his own face. And, you know, usually we're quite, neither of us can be bothered, right? It's the worst podcast ever because we don't care. We don't care about it. It's like a contractual thing. We just do it. We hate it. It's do not listen to it. It's rubbish, right? And okay. we usually do it. We usually spend about 30 minutes in it. 30 minutes doing it, and sort of, you know, I slow everything down so it goes to 45. It's terrible. It's unlistenable. And this one we took 3 hours, and at the end I sort of almost came to the sort of breakdown conclusion of, I bought Twisted Pair to watch. I had to buy it from Neil Breen, from his own website. I had to wait about 6 weeks for it to turn up. And it cost me $30. And I realized I've probably given David Lynch about $12 in my entire life. And I've given this dickhead $30. And I felt, like, ashamed. And that's what and I never edited it because I felt like it just... It just changed things for me. I just couldn't go back to it.
Oh, man. That's,
yeah. Because I used to really enjoy watching his stuff, and I don't know. It's curdled for me.
The last one didn't... Is it that you fell in love with... Or you fell out of love with it entirely, or was it just that Twisted Pair was so far over the top that you just it caused a breaking point in you where you said, "Oh, this, what am I doing with my life?"
it was that, and also it was 3 hours, so I couldn't really be bothered. But also,
God, the movie's 3 hours.
No, it's not 3 hours. The podcast was 3 hours.
Oh, sorry, bigger problem.
No, but it was long and arduous. Yeah, it was sort of like, what am I doing with my life? And, you know, once you get on to sort of, Twisted Pair is rubbish, you know, I mean, the student work, that is better. Mm-hmm. And I wouldn't want to dissect that. It wouldn't be fair. Yeah, I almost think it's unfair now for me to sort of mock him because there's something wrong with him.
I get what you're saying. I do. I've thought about that myself in a couple of cases where it's like, well, you know, when you and I are talking about, hey, do you want to see this film? Do you want to see this film? Certain ones come to mind where I'm like, let's watch this, and then I think, I don't want to pick a film just to beat it up. You know, I want to look for movies that have really positive aspects that you can kind of celebrate and.
Yes, there seems to be a lot more to talk about, really, when you talk about why things work than
yes.
why they don't.
Well, there's cases where it's interesting to talk about something that failed when it was such a
when it could have succeeded.
Failure. Well, yeah, in cases where it should have been a lot better and somebody clearly screwed something up. I think that's interesting, but I like talking about the good stuff probably more. So
about Schmidt.
Yeah, Schmidt, man.
What
else is there to say?
Well, yeah, I guess that's sort of why we went off. The only other thing I wanted to mention was there are two occasions, one at the beginning where I think he's talking about thanking Randall for a gift. And during his final speech, his wedding speech, where he's talking about meeting the family, he describes whatever gift he got from Randall as, thank you for that item. And then he describes Renata's ex-husband's new wife, Sandra, he describes something she showed him as that wonderful item.
Yes.
And I was just wondering if you had any theories as to why the word item was used like that twice.
For me, it just kind of feels like whatever that item was, it wasn't impressive enough to him to have impacted him so that he could remember it. It seemed like a very indefinite hedge. You know what else I noticed? It was something kind of on this topic. When he goes back to his office to speak to the young executive that replaced him.
Yeah.
When he walks into the office, the executive says, hey, there he is. Have a seat there, partner.
Like, and he doesn't remember his name.
That's what people say when they don't remember your name right off, right? Later in that scene, he refers to him by name. He calls him Warren. So it's either he knew the guy's name all along and he gets by on that kind of you know, low value small talky bullshit when he greets people, or there was a period there when he was going, oh God, I don't remember his name, and then he kind of dredged it up while they were having that discussion, and I'm not sure which that was, but
or it could even be like, why are you here? Did we sort of, because, well, you know, it's not expected.
It seems like the guy never missed a beat, though. Like, he was on the phone, and Schmidt kind of pops his head, and he looks up, and he just, oh, yeah, come on, sit down. And that guy seems like his entire life is like 99% just bullshit. Constantly.
Shit off a shovel, yeah.
Yeah. But it seemed like that same kind of thing. And I heard that on my second viewing, the same way you did. Where, oh, that item you showed me was... It's like you're spending all this time, you've got a captive audience. It's this large room full of people, and you're going to spend all this time discussing each little person like it's the Wizard of Oz. And here's what I'm going to miss the most about you. But you just showed me an item. It seemed like he forgot what it was, and he was just looking for a nice thing to say to everybody.
And yes.
You know, again, that scene felt like it was more about him.
Oh, yeah.
Than it was about his daughter. Just like when it was his retirement party, his his replacement gets up to start making a speech about him, but he immediately turns the speech into it's all about him. Oh, I just moved here recently with my family, and starts giving his life history. That seems to be recurring in the film, where it's like an occasion to honor somebody, and somebody stands up and redirects it and tries to make it all about them.
As you know, my wife died recently.
Yeah. It's just suddenly it's all about how this relates to me and how it affects me and how it's impacted my life.
But he starts there. When he starts the speech, he doesn't know what he's going to say.
He kind of course corrects, doesn't he?
And then he course corrects. He realizes, no, I can't stop. In my opinion, he realizes, no, I can't stop the wedding. If I fucking say something now, she will never speak to me again. That is not the thing to do.
I'll be right? on the outs.
And I have nothing prepared. And what's the thing to do then? Okay, well, I will now produce the most charming speech I can think of off the cuff, which is, I met you and it was really nice to meet you. You helped me one time. I remember that. That's a shared memory. Thank you. Awesome. It was so nice to meet you. You're a wonderful family. I am very pleased. and then everyone's sort of there, and only really the daughter sort of recognizes it as not positive.
That's, you know, I dug that, because I thought the first time I saw that speech, I thought that was him having his moment. I thought that was him maturing and finally coming to grips with his daughter. You know, she's my own woman. I didn't realize it was him accepting defeat and looking for whatever win he could get his hands on walking out of there. And then when he got to the end and said, I'm very pleased, and you saw the look on his daughter's face, that kind of tells you exactly, it confirms your suspicions about what's going on in his head. Because you can see it through her eyes. She goes, oh, I can't fucking believe that was all he could come up with, pleased.
But then you could look at that as in, you could look at I am very pleased as in him having a dig at her.
I don't think it was a dig. I think that was all he could bring himself to say. Like, that was the most positive he could be.
He's not happy. He's not happy throughout the entire film. He's not been happy for many, many years. Mm. And
If ever.
And yeah, I thought that was very good, because I thought I both felt like that was a little triumph in you know, good for you that you didn't ruin her wedding.
Yeah.
But at the same time as like you said, like, that's the best you could come up with.
Yeah, I mean, it showed.
But at
it
least
showed,
he didn't say.
It showed minimal growth. I mean, you could see where he wanted to just fly off when his breathing quickened or started to quiver, and he said, "You know what I really want to say?" And I was waiting. Don't do it, man. Just stop. You know, and he went the direction you hoped he would, but it's not a complete win. It's not the victory you want it to be. It's a depleted victory. I'm not even sure what the proper word for it is, but it gets undercut right at the end with I'm pleased. It's great.
Yeah, the moment between I am very and then pleased is
it really pulls the wind out of everything he said before that, because he was very gracious. He was very kind, and it felt, for me, it felt like him accepting, these aren't people that I understand, but they are essentially good people. And you know what I mean? And
could be worse.
Yes, exactly. You know, they could be hateful. They could be a bunch of drug dealers or involved in it. It felt like him finally coming to a point where he could let something go. But then when he said, I'm very pleased, for me, it kind of cemented, oh, okay, he's making sure he says things very carefully. He's picking his words, and there's a certain point where he can't push himself any further. Saying I'm elated, I'm happy, I'm grateful, that's a bridge too far for him. he can't get any more excited than pleased.
I wonder how different it would be and how more acute his snobbishness would feel if the family she was marrying into was black.
That would.
I mean, it would change it.
That would create a completely different story at that point. I think it would sort of.
I think it is sort of about class on some level, and it would almost dilute that, really.
I think it would take the tension in the wrong direction.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. That seems like a complication I don't want to deal with the character, because if we're being honest, if we're being true to the character, I think he would have a problem with a black family.
Yeah, not necessarily because he's, you know, racist.
No, I think
he's a bit racist.
I think it would just be because the culture is so...
Well, yeah, because he's conservative so different. And he's isolated and closed off.
Yes. Because I'm trying to imagine him at one of my family's barbecues. My father-in-law is a black man, so there's this whole family that I love to get together with, because the barbecue is it sounds terrible to say, right? But it really is the culture of the kind of party that they throw when we all get together. It's a blast every time. It's like you can't get enough of it. And I'm trying to picture Schmidt in that situation with, you know, a loud, boisterous family. There's loud music, there's usually some thumping going, there's lots of drinking, sometimes maybe people stumble a little bit, and he seems too uptight for that kind of fun. And I think if you tried to tell the movie from that perspective, or tell the story from that perspective, it raises questions about who he is as a character that are beside the point. You know, I wouldn't want the audience going down that road with him. It's like, no, this is 100% class. It doesn't have to do with bigotry. It's really just this closed off worldview and an ignorance to people in general. So I think if you have him looking at his own race in that fashion, it gets the point across. He'd be like that with anybody, as long as their social standing wasn't where he wanted it.
Yeah, you know? If they're slightly lower class than him. Well, I agree. And I think that he would... I mean, again, it's just conjecture, really, but I think that he might be more receptive to a classier black family than a less classier white family.
Yes.
Possibly. I think, I would say class is actually quite important.
That's the thing. I think having that race component just confuses his motivation.
So,
and his motivation is not cut and dried to begin with, so
no.
You would want to avoid any confusion as much as possible.
I mean, I was just going to say, I mean, I don't think this, but they're not, you know, the family aren't meant to be Jewish because their last name's Herzl.
I didn't even think about that.
I didn't even think about that either, because I think that their name only comes up once. And if they are meant to be Jewish, it's very not obvious.
Yeah, non-traditionally Jewish family.
Yeah, his religion isn't. Yeah, I mean, yeah, they're getting married in a church. So they're not meant to be Jewish, are they?
Yeah, no, they're not... I don't, there's none of the customs that you'd see in a Jewish wedding.
Right, and his religion's pretty unclear as well.
So it's probably just a name that comes from that region.
Yeah. I just wondered.
I think that's what I really appreciate the most about this movie. There's no fat like that.
Mm-hmm.
There's not really anything to weigh it down and confuse what the point is. I mean it comes through very quickly. I enjoy films where the point is a little obscure and you have to dig for it, but this one is very much on the nose, and it needs to be. I like that it is. There's no point in the film where you're confused about how someone feels. You might be confused about what makes them tick or what their motivation is, but you know exactly what they're feeling at any given moment.
Yes, I agree. What did you think about the end?
I thought it was in perfect keeping with the rest of the story. Because he got, in a sense, he got what he was looking for. He was really looking to mean something to someone somewhere still. He was looking for that connection. He was looking to still be useful. He got that moment. I don't know how much impact it really would have to him over a long period of time, but at the moment, he got exactly what it was that he needed. At the same time, from all of his past behavior in the film, I don't know if he's going to grow from that.
Yes.
I don't know if that's going to be transformative and he sees life in a new way after that moment. I don't know if he's just going to go back to being the same Schmidt that we've seen through the whole film. It's really hard for me to say what that means.
Yes, and I think it's quite good that you don't know. I mean, It'd be terrible if they did about Schmidt too, and he takes his Winnebago to Tanzania.
That would be awful.
So at the end, so again, really spoilers. At the end, he gets the message from Ndugu. Not the message. He gets a letter from the charity group that sponsoring Ndugu.
It's the missionary who works with him, isn't it?
The missionary writes to him, and she includes a picture Ndugu has drawn of him, which is very nice of Ndugu to do. And I just wanted to say that I think that the voice they got for the nun is brilliant.
He thinks of you every day, and he wants very much your happiness. Ndugu is only 6 years old and cannot read or write, but he has made for you a painting.
I think it's one of the best casting choices I've ever heard. I don't know who it is.
Really?
Yes, because you can tell that she's old. And I think that really matters. And I think it would actually be... I think it was an effort, probably. Not you know, an impossible effort. But I think it was probably an effort to find someone who has an old voice who speaks with such a convincing French accent.
Hmm. And...
It sounded like that was a nun. Do you know what I mean?
It sounded so convincing. I get that.
And it fit what she was saying so well. And I think it's more important than it initially seems. Not in terms of changing meaning, but just in terms of effect.
Yeah, well, I know that scene has impact. It was hard for me to watch that scene without feeling what he was feeling. I think it's good that it came from the missionary. It would have felt contrived if it was supposed to be a letter directly from Ndugu, right? It doesn't make sense that he'd get to have that much. But I do like what she wrote to him. And you know, the picture says everything you need it to. And Nicholson crying at the end of it was, God, I start thinking about the technicalities of what he would have to do, because that was a camera like right up in his face when he had to do that scene, and he had to pull that off with a big black lens right in front of him. I guess there's a reason why they get the money they do. It was pretty impressive.
Yeah, agents.
Well, yeah. Well, look, Patrick Stewart is a very respected actor, right? If you watch him in a movie where he has to cry, it's not very good. He doesn't cry dramatically, I think, in a very convincing way. And to see Nicholson, who, again, he has kind of the reputation that he does, it's really impressive to see him be able to go to that place and have it look as real as it does.
I think that they, you know, not to disagree entirely, but I think they might have had quite a fairly long lens. You know, so...
Oh, pull it back a little?
So it might not have been super close, but I know what you mean. Fair enough. I mean, it's so convincing, and it is there. Yeah, I wonder how long that took, and I wonder what he was thinking.
Oh, Jesus.
When he did that.
Yeah, I don't know, but it was really good.
Thank you.
There's not much more you can say about it other than how good it was, which sounds boorish after a minute.
I remember being on a short film where the director said to the actor, okay, when I say now, start crying.
Oh, man. Is that how it works?
No. They were friends, right? He and the actor were friends, and I think the actor said something like, what the fuck are you talking about, Steve?
Well, good. So he wasn't he wasn't intimidated. I imagine it must be something like, look, just sit there and give us a signal when we should hit the record button, right? We're just going to sit in the next room and wait. I'll bet they even have to like hide around a corner or something just so the person can be kind of by themselves.
I recorded I did a sort of student sort of exercise type film, but I did it with real actors. You know, like just a 5-minute thing, and so someone had to cry in that. And the way we did it was I only wanted to get the crying from one shot, so we just started and let it roll and sort of let him take his time with it. So, you know, they might have 10 minutes of Jack Nicholson sort of stood there, sort of building it up while everyone is silent.
Yeah. That's crazy stuff. There's got to be a lot of, there's got to be a lot of trust between the actors and the directors. When it's good, when everything is moving the way it needs to, because I can only imagine the kind of silly things that actors must come up with while they're trying to explore a scene or figure out how it's going to work. And then they're really relying on the director and the editor to just pick the thing that makes them look the least ridiculous.
Yes. They have to trust in that process. Yeah.
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 Oh
yeah. Yeah.
I just, you're not going to make me look like an asshole, right? No. It's going to be very good. And then you hope you don't look foolish, I guess, when it comes out in the theater. That's gotta be scary as hell, man. To be an actor and go to a premiere and you haven't seen the final cut of the movie.
Nicholson got an Emmy for this, I think.
Didn't get an Oscar.
He didn't get an Oscar. I think he was nominated.
Oh God, that's pretty shitty. He should have got an Oscar for this movie.
But during his Emmy speech, he got Best Actor in a Drama, and he said, "I'm really surprised because I thought we'd made a comedy." so maybe he was crying and he thought that the director was going to cut it in such a way where it's hilarious that he starts crying, and you know, maybe those tears aren't real at all. Maybe he just jammed some soap in his eyes or something.
I don't know. I thought it
looked real, didn't it? Yeah,
they held the shot on him for a long time, and you could see his eyes redden right there on the camera.
He did a massive bong before they started shooting and just let it sort of roll that, out. Yeah.
You've got me thinking about the Big Lebowski now. That was usually how they filmed scenes. Bridges would go up to the directors and say, "Hey man, do you think the dude burned one on the way over here?"
Really? I didn't know that. That's awesome.
And they'd tell him, I think he must have had a joint on the way over here. And he'd go, "Oh, great." And then he'd kind of go over to the corner and he'd take his knuckles and just dig them into his eyes for like a good 5 minutes or so. And then he'd get them good and red. And that's how they did the scene.
That's not what I thought you were going to say. Okay. Well, that's still cool.
It's probably a better story if he just went and smoked one. But
it might slow the production down a little bit.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, the guy's a professional. He's only going to do that stuff like after lunch, not before.
After lunch, so you're still doing it before the shots and everything, just not the first half of the day.
Yeah, you gotta
get to 5 p.m. Like, he is fucked.
There's the important stuff that you got to get through in the morning, right? There's like the coffee and the donuts, and I guess there's the sitting around and waiting for the scene to be ready and lit, and then you got to go. At some point, you gotta warm up with a quick toot.
In his trailer.
Oh, come on! You've seen with Jeff Bridges. You've seen that man. He does not go through his day sober.
I don't know. I mean, it depends what you mean by sober as well, doesn't it? Some people need weed to help them get sober.
God.
to help them come down, maybe. I don't know. I feel like I'm casting aspersions on someone now.
No. I have nothing against it personally. It's just there's it seems like there's a certain individual who can function through that cloud, which is impressive. Seems like you're operating on a kind of the wrong gear. Maybe not. I don't know.
I don't know. Definitely a different gear, maybe.
Yeah, well,
So.
I think you're meant to process things differently or see things in a different light. I don't know. I have to be completely in my right mind and hopped up on caffeine to write anything cogent at all.
So you never drink?
Well, no, I do. I don't drink much,
Right.
but I don't do it when I'm working.
Right.
So sometimes I'll have like an idea that comes up while I'm a little inebriated. And I think that the chemicals do they'll put your mind in a different state where you'll consider problems differently and come up with unique solutions or ideas that you wouldn't have had. But it's I think that's a very limited utility.
I agree. I think it would be very difficult to. I mean, when people talk about, oh, such and such a writer wrote things when they were drunk, I think, it's quite rare for people to write things when they're very drunk. You sort of, oh, I'm a bit tipsy. Yeah,
Well, I
that
think it
could get me
becomes,
going, but.
I think it becomes part of the mystique too, and then they start feeling like, well, I need to be doing this because this is my image. I'm thinking of Bukowski now, like
Yeah.
that was always his thing. Oh, I'm always drinking beer, and he always had to have wine when he was working on his poems or his novels, and.
I mean, the fact that he was drinking beer is the clue that it's bullshit. Like, you do it properly. What's
Well, I
beer
mean.
gonna do?
Well, he didn't have a great deal of money, so I think he just kind of got by on what he could. He
He go
said
get some mezcal.
he said he preferred wine when he was writing because he couldn't get catastrophically drunk off of the wine. It was just something that could kind of get a buzz going for him
Yeah.
and let him work for a period. But I really do think that especially if you're an addictive personality, like you don't want to get yourself to a point where you think you need
You need it,
that
yeah.
substance to start producing something. It
Yeah.
seems like a da very dangerous place to go.
Yes, I agree. It starts with a ritual and it ends with you needing it.
Yeah, then it becomes self-destructive.
Yeah.
It's not something you can sustain, I don't
Yeah,
think.
or yeah, at the very least it becomes yeah, I mean, maybe yeah, maybe often self-destructive, but at least unhelpful.
Yeah, well, again, I think it's good for the odd idea, but it's not anything that I would want to like keep falling back on. Like, oh, it's time to write a new book. Let me get that bottle of schnapps or whatever. Right. I'm gonna do a line.
I'm gonna do a line. Yeah. Sterilize the needles.
Yeah, I don't know if that's good. Something like that, I don't know if it's very good for creativity. Like, it seems that
No, it's
if you
very good for talking someone's ear off, I think,
yes.
and little else.
I think that probably something like an alcohol or perhaps a depressant is good for interesting ideas. Like you get a good premise from that. Or maybe weed does the same thing. But you can write that down, but that's not good for work. Like for work, you need
Yeah.
something that's a little bit of a stimulant. Like coffee, caffeine for me is the stuff.
Yeah.
I'm sure I drink too much of that when I'm working. But at the same time, I can sit down and crack out about 5,000 words, and it's like, oh, where did the time go? So,
Wow, 5,000 words. You do that all at once.
yeah, I do. It's usually 5,000 usable words. It's
I
not.
Wow, 5,000 use okay, because I used to I've been able to do 5,000 words, but only when I'm drinking. And out of that, I'd probably say like 3 words are usable.
When three.
Yeah.
Well, when I first started writing, I'm finding that the words become less and less usable the more practice I get. Like the early when I started, I'd write something I thought, oh, that's great, that's fine, and I don't need to touch that up. And you come back and look at it later and go, oh my God, what have I done? So now I'm finding like the edits happen more and more, and I'm really I tend to refine what I'm doing far more than when I started. When I started, though, it was so frantic. It was almost like I couldn't turn it off.
I know, yes, I know what you mean. I think a lot of people go through that.
There were weekends where I couldn't stop. Like I'd be sitting on the couch, my wife would have the TV on. Our kid would be like doing some Legos or something at the table, and I'd be pop, 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 just going.
Yeah.
And there were a few sessions where I would sit down and then not look up again until it was dark outside. And my wife is telling me, it's time to go to bed. And I've written 10,000 words in one sitting. And it's not like that anymore. It's kind of slowed down now. But yeah, in the beginning, it was like I couldn't shut it off. And I seem to be kind of coming on to a good balance that works now, where I'm balancing all of the responsibilities that I have. So now I, you know, when one session, I do a lot of writing on weekends now, like just rushing while everybody's asleep. And you know, that might be a 2,500 to 3,000 word session, which sounds more human to me. And every once in a while, I'll go crazy and I'll crack out five, and I don't know where it happened.
I know Enid Blyton used to do 5,000 words a day, and she would do it to the number, to exactly 5,000. She would just stop.
Wow.
Even if it was halfway through a sentence.
I think it's dangerous to think about the number too much.
Well, I agree. I absolutely agree.
I see that a lot. There's this. Well, you know, we do this for Keystroke Medium. They've got a writer challenge that they do where it's, hey, we're going to compete for who can write the most words. And I think, okay, well, that's fun. That's kind of a motivating principle to help you get things going. But at the same time, it's like, how many of those words that you're writing, how many of them are good? If you're trying to, you know, get a piece of work together and publish it. I mean, were those the words that needed to be there? Were those the words that you put there because you were so focused on a number? And I would hope that people are using the contest in a way that doesn't hamper what they're trying to do.
Is it a contest with a prize?
No. I don't really think it. I think it's just bragging rights.
Right. Okay.
It's really just, you know, there's a lot of people who they're writing and they want to improve their skills and they want to publish things, or there might be people in the group that actually are published authors, to one degree of success or another, and they're looking for ways to exercise to kind of build up their writing muscles. So they say, oh, we're going to have a word count challenge and we're going to track everybody on a spreadsheet and we go to this specific time and whoever got the most words wins. And, you know, again, sounds
okay.
I could see where it sounds motivating. It's just like for me personally, someone who does it for a living, this doesn't mean anything at all. Nothing against the contest. I don't see why. I don't see the point.
Nothing against the contest. Your contest is completely pointless.
Yeah, no, I don't think it's that, but it's just for me personally, I don't see the utility for me. But maybe that's
for you.
Well, or for anybody who's like actually doing it. You know what I mean? It seems like a fun warm-up exercise for people to kind of work with, but if you're doing it for a living, and you've kind of figured out your process, you've kind of fallen into your rhythms, you don't need things like that anymore. At least that's the way I see it.
I agree. I think that there's a tremendous. Do you want to talk about this? I don't know. We've gone off into talking about writing.
Oh, I don't care.
We can.
I'm kind of the opinion that we finished with Schmidt.
We have. Yeah. I mean, if you haven't seen it, watch it. It's really good. But
I think we've discussed it enough, and now I think I'm just kind of bullshitting with you. And
I think, well, what I was going to say, because we are talking about writing now, and I'm interested.
Yeah, that's fine.
I think that, not just with writing, but with anything creative or artistic, I think there's a tremendous amount of guilt people have surrounding the amount of time they put into things.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people feel like, you know, I think most people, you know, when they're doing these things, they often have another job anyway. But when they don't, I think they often sort of feel like I've got to be doing it 8 hours a day. I've got to be working on this. It's got to be hard. And I definitely have had that. I've had that a lot. And, you know, a lot of my, I suppose sort of lack of progress and frustrations in my earlier life came from taking on too much. And I wouldn't say no to things. I would, you know, if someone wanted me to help them on their project, even though it's not really anything to do with what I'm doing, I'd say yes. You know, I didn't want to turn anything down. I wanted to do as much as possible. And I would beat myself up if I'd spent, you know, 3 hours not working or something. And I think that's, in a way, it's dangerous to feel like that. In a way, it's dangerous to make yourself right. I'm not sure if we said this last time when we were talking, but
I think we touched on it, though. But I also think that it's something that bears repeating. First of all, I can really understand where that feeling comes from, though. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, if that is someone's watching this and that's their process and it works for them, good. I think it can work for people, definitely, but not for me anyway.
No, but I can understand that drive to do it too, especially if your only means of income was writing.
I can understand it.
Because the money when you write novels, it's really uneven. You know, you put a book out and then if you're fortunate, if you're a successful writer, then there's a good, I don't know, 3 to 4 month period where the money's nuts. And then it starts to taper off. And the tapering off in my experience has been a slow taper. Like you get another good 3 or 4 months of really nice earnings. But then after that, it's almost like it falls off a cliff.
Mm.
And then it just comes in at a trickle, and that's not enough to live off of. So for me, that doesn't bother me at all because I also have a day job, and that job it takes care of me. If my only thing was writing, and I saw that money doing that roller coaster ride, I would feel so anxious. You know, I got my family that's depending on me to keep a roof over the head, keep food on the table, keep the healthcare paid and all that. I could really see feeling like I've got to be working at it every day or I'm in deep trouble.
Yeah. Yes, I agree. I can definitely see that and getting into it, but I think that can lead to problems where
it can lead to creative problems, I think.
Really shouldn't be pushed out. I think, you know, for me, so I'm editing a film at the moment that I shot. I am in the process of, I have edited it in an assembly edit, and I'm starting to work on the composition with the score with the composer and the sound design. And over Christmas, I didn't do anything with it. I do a series every year where I do 13, I look at 13 different films and I do very short videos about them. And it takes a bit of time to do them. So I spent about 5 or 6 weeks away from the film, away from editing it. I didn't even open the editor, and it helped. It helped a lot.
You weren't feeling any anxiety by being away from it that long?
No.
Oh, good. No, that's great.
I finished the assembly, and I'm going to spend probably. So I've you know the last week, 10 days, I've worked on it a lot. You know, every day.
Mm-hmm.
I've worked on it a lot, and now I'm going to spend another couple of weeks before I go back to it. And I find that my own thinking about it evolves, and it's easier for me to look back at things and think, right, okay, so this works, but I need to change it like this. Whereas, you know, if you do it and you look back at it, you're still in the mode of the reasoning of why you did it originally.
Yes.
I think space is really important and helpful. And obviously that's a luxury.
Yeah, no, that's interesting, though, because that's almost counterintuitive to the way I see things.
Right.
I guess counterintuitive isn't the word, but it's kind of counter to how I process. I'm going to say, though, that if it works for you, if you can do that and you don't feel anxious at any point or like, oh, I've been away from it, then that's good. That's obviously the right thing to do. For me, I get really tense when it takes too long to finish a book.
Right.
Or what I consider to be too long to finish a book. because I don't like to take too much time to get it out, because I'm afraid that by the time I get to the end, where my brain is at is going to be so different from where it was when I started that I'm not going to be able to complete my thought.
Yeah, I do.
I don't know if that makes sense, but it's like when I sit down to plan a story, I've got this idea that I want to convey. So it's like there's some point that I'm going to make, and there's some way that I'm going to get you to that point. So when I start writing the thing, I may have a sequence of events that I think perfectly illustrates the point that I'm trying to say. If I take too long to write the thing, and I get to the end of it, like I start feeling like, what if I don't want to make that point anymore, or I think that point is no longer relevant? It's almost like I'm racing myself to finish the book before it stops being interesting to me.
So like if you spend like 5 years writing a book, you're clearly going to be a different person when you finish it you started.
There's no way I could do that unless it was highly research based. If it was all research and facts and empirical evidence, then yeah, I could do that for 5 years. But something that was creative, there's no way I couldn't do it.
But you're only 41. I mean, maybe it's something you won't be able to do until you're old. But you know what I mean.
I'm still kicking by that time. That's a good point. I imagine that once you get to a certain age, like the degree to which you change, probably stops.
Surely.
I mean, I don't know. What I can tell you is that the most change in worldview that I've ever had in my life has been over just the last couple of years.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yes. Yeah. It feels to me like the way I see the world and process it around me, it's in this tremendous state of change, and it seems to be accelerating. It's like the way I look at things and decide how I want to feel about them, it's been in this crazy state of flux. And I think it all has to do with how much I've been writing, and how my family's life has changed since that started. And it's kind of given me space to think about certain things and how the things that I've always considered to be like true hard fact. Right. I guess I've gotten kind of philosophical. So well,
can you give us an example?
It's really just the problem is I would have to get a little political to explain this, but and I really don't like discussing politics publicly.
Well, we can skip it if you want.
The end of the story is kind of who I'm positive on right now for the presidential election, and I don't want to say who it is because it's just I feel like we talk about that too much. But what I will say is that, you know, and it's the same thing that happens when we're young versus when we grow and we get perspective on the world. When we're younger, we have much more concrete opinions about what is and is not, you know, and it was very easy for me as a young man to see the world in a black and white fashion. This is on or off, true, false. And the reason it was easy for me to see the world in that way is because it took less effort to do so. Seeing the world in a black and white fashion, in my view, it takes the burden off of you to consider things.
You need experience before you can see the gray.
Yeah. And as I've gotten older, I'm seeing things with more nuance. Here's a good example, because it has less to do with politics and more with culture and society. It used to be really easy for me to discount the opinions of a younger generation as, oh, you snowflake.
Oh, I see.
Quit your bitching, right? But as my viewpoints on that have been challenged, and as I've taken the time to look out a little bit further beyond my own nose, it gets really hard for me to condemn the younger generation for anything, because the world that they're growing up in is something that we've never seen before in human history. It's so complex now compared to anything that we've known before. And I have to imagine that growing up under those conditions is going to fuck with some things. You know, it's gonna make a decidedly different generation of people. I think the internet is impacting us a lot more than we understand or realize, and I don't necessarily know that it's all good.
No, it's not all good.
But it's not all bad as well, obviously.
No, it's not all bad. No, definitely it's not all
bad. But it's just, you know, when I got out of high school, it was possible to go to college. You get a degree. And, you know, if you were more privileged than others, maybe your parents had put a little aside for you and you could go to school, right?
Can I just interrupt you? Because you're an engineer, right?
Yes.
I'll tell you something. When I went to college, I met someone who was about 5 years older than me, and they'd done a City Guilds degree in engineering, and it had taken them 4 years. And they had started with £0, and they came out of it about £600 up, and they owed nothing.
Wow.
Because they got a grant to mm-hmm. go and do it. The government paid for them to do it. They didn't have anything to pay back. And they even saved some.
Yeah, I think.
And it's not like that now in Britain.
Well, yeah, but that's kind of a
sorry to derail you there.
Oh no, that's absolutely fine. That's interesting to me. That's another example of how my worldview has changed. Growing up in America, and especially growing up to, you know, Republican parents, they voted Reagan and all that. For the longest time, the idea I had was, you pay for everything on your own. You know, you go pay for your own education. The state shouldn't have to pay for that. But then I see how things work in other countries. I see that in Germany, you can go to any college you want to absolutely free. You just have you have to have the grades, you know, you have to have the performance and you get accepted in. And I kind of wonder about that. It's like, why should we have a situation in America where you have a whole population of children who are told from the day they get into the institution, the way to succeed is college. The only way through is college. That's the only way your life is going to mean anything. And then by the time you get there, you figure out, well, I'm going to go to college. I might have a degree that gets me a decent job when I get out, but I'm also going to be strapped with about $85,000 in debt. Like I'm going to come out of college with a house payment on my back already. And that seems debilitating to me. Like I don't know that wasn't the story that was told to me when I started my life out, but that's now what the reality is for a lot of young kids. And it's like, God damn, we couldn't do better than this. Like really, this is what it's come to now.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, one of the things they teach in Harvard Business School is that if there's a job out there that you want and it doesn't exist, make it exist. You know, if you want to be I don't know. I mean, if you want to sort of get into, you know, parts of aerospace that don't exist, you make it happen. And yeah. I think another part of that could be, you know, if you want to set up a business, if you want to go into film, if you want to do all this and this and this, you don't need a degree. You need a degree to be a doctor. You need a degree to be a lawyer. I don't think, you know, I mean, I did a degree in film, and I did it sort of before it became very expensive to do, you know, to go to university. But, you know, part of the reason I did a degree was everyone does a degree.
Yes.
Or not everyone, but I went to a very middle-class school. I went to two schools. I went to a really working-class school, and then I went to a really middle-class school. Mm. And I remember the teacher, was about 18, saying, everyone here, put your hand up if you're going to university. And there was about 70 kids, and I was one of two who weren't. And I ended up going anyway the year after.
Yeah.
And, you know, it was the thing to do. And really, like I said to you before, I mean, my degree, it isn't worthless, but I've never got a job from it.
Yeah. It's, you know. And I think there's a lot of people that are finding that.
I mean, my true knowledge of, you know, I like to think that I'm fairly knowledgeable about film. I'm definitely not an expert, but a degree doesn't make you an expert anyway. But all my real knowledge, if there is any, has been self-built. It has not really come from the degree.
It's been through practical application.
Yeah.
I think that's another piece of the puzzle for me anyway, is that it's so it's so touted as the critical factor, and so many times it ends up not being. That doesn't mean that college is stupid and
no.
set it aside, but it might mean
think about
that
it.
if college isn't for you, maybe don't cripple yourself with debt until you know for sure.
Yeah.
Because there are a lot of different paths that one can take. And you know, they say at Harvard Business School, if the job doesn't exist or the business doesn't exist, create it. That's true. There is the opportunity to do that. Does everybody have the wherewithal or the know-how to do it? I don't know.
Oh, definitely not.
Right. But at the same time, like...
I think at Harvard Business School, they assume you are a person of means.
Well, let me...
All you got to do if you want to be rich is you're just getting your dad's Lamborghini, right? You go down to the... you know, yeah.
Yeah. Well, let me counter what you said with something of my own. I'm an engineer. I work in the aerospace business. I don't have an engineering degree.
Right, okay.
I kind of fell into that by accident.
I think a lot of people fall into things that they end up being quite successful at.
I've told the story. I don't know if I've told the story to you. If this sounds familiar, stop me quickly.
Okay.
But yeah, what it was I got a degree in information systems. Because right. I wanted to make computer games.
Right, okay. Cool.
But... I didn't, like, I was so clueless at the time that I didn't really know what degree you need to go get to do that.
Exactly the same.
I ended up at a college where it was almost like a military recruitment, where it was like, you know, if I go here, am I going to learn to make games? Oh, yeah, just sign on the dotted line, and, you know, you sign here. And the next thing you know, you're learning to make, relational databases and accounting software.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I had gotten... close enough to the end where I realized what I was being trained to become, because they give us, you know, enough programming classes where it's like, oh, okay, I can go do this. But really, if you want to do computer games, back then you got a computer science degree, which was a little bit different than an information systems degree. Computer science is like the really hard science of computing, whereas information systems is kind of like, we're just crunching data. We're conditioning data, and we're doing interesting things with data, analyzing it, statistics. And I realized what I was supposed to be with that education, and I was horrified, because I just, what have I done? I thought that I had just slotted myself into a Schmidt existence, you know, like risk assessment. It was going to be doing something that I had no passion for at all. And then I randomly kind of fell into this job doing, embedded software for helicopters, because the person who was interviewing me liked that I was a construction worker at some point, and he was impressed by kind of that blue collar physical work ethic. So I got a job.
Which he assumed you have. You could have been a terrible construction worker.
Well, he lucked out in that I kind of did have that, but it's really weird. Like, the whole reason I have the position I have today, which is a pretty good job, in a position of respect at my company. It's like, I've got a senior engineer position, and all of that goes back to somebody was impressed that I had swung a hammer for a living once upon a time. Like, that's where it all starts. It's very strange.
Yeah.
None of that had anything to do with my degree, though.
Yeah.
Guy didn't even look at it.
I think all the jobs, not all the jobs, but I've definitely never had to show anyone my degree or gotten a job because I have a degree. But the whole thing about, you know, doing the about Schmidt thing and getting sort of sucked in, I think it's the same almost everywhere, because in creative industries, certainly, I mean, my experience is in the British film industry, which is, you know, something.
I don't know what meaning to take from you saying.
Well, it's obviously
something.
It's obviously much, much smaller than the American film industry,
okay,
you know, and I've never gone through that at all. So that's my perspective. So I do have a blind spot there, is what I'm saying.
Hmm.
But really, that instead of, you know, most people sort of sacrifice their big dreams, their dreams of, you know, I want to make video games for the check, right? Well, it's not making video games. No, I'm not saying this is necessarily what happened to you, but I think a lot of people go on a similar route. I want to make video games. I want to do this. This looks like a fun profession. And then it's sort of like, well, you know, you're not going to make video games. You're going to formulate data for us. But here's a check, and it's not too bad. And you can live, and you can grow.
Yeah.
And that's how they get you. And I think a lot of people, when they're young, go into the creative industry thinking this and thinking, I don't want to be part of that. But in creative industries, they don't even give you the fucking check, right? What they do is they say, I promise
they pay you,
one day,
pay you with exposure.
You'll be making your thing, right? I tell you what, I promise you, if you do this, if you're a PA for us, we won't pay you very well. Some of these actors will treat you like shit, right? No. You'll get treated like shit. You'll be running my laundry all the time. But maybe in 10 years after you've been in the studio, maybe you'll get a shot. And you get all these people who either work for nothing or work for very little or take really bad working environments because they're hoping that one day I won't be some poor bastard, shading stuff for Rockstar who has to work 80 hours a week. One day I'll be making creative decisions. And that's how they get those people. It's the same thing. It's just instead of money, it's one day you'll have the opportunity to be creative. I think.
Yeah, but. At least you can pay your bills in one case. That sounds rough.
Well, you can pay your bills in the creative industry. I just think that they get you a different way.
It sounds though.
Creative industry, you know what I mean?
Right. Well, anything kind of media based.
Anything media based, and it's not all like that, I guess. But
sure. But it is from a film perspective. It really sounds like you're bottom feeding for a long time.
You think about it, right? If you want to be a computer animator, you're going to do a 3-year degree, you're going to do a master's. You're not going to walk into Pixar and start designing characters. No, you're going to walk into Pixar and start like shading in something.
Yeah, you start as an apprentice or something.
Yeah, and you do that for years. And it's like that everywhere.
Yes. Well, I think that was kind of interesting. My parents believed this story that they always told me. And they said, you can have any job you want as long as you get a good education. And I think that when they were growing up, that was true. I think that's how it worked. You get a good education.
When they were growing up, it was true as long as you weren't black.
Well, okay.
Or maybe a woman.
That's yes. That is also true.
It was a little flatter, though, is what you're saying.
Yeah, it was basic. Well, they grew up in a time where you still were able to have a single income home on a factory job.
Right.
Like that was the area they came from. My dad was born in 47. So when I was a kid in the 80s, that's what I heard. Get a good degree, you'll be able to do whatever job you want. And that's kind of true. It does open the door for you.
Well, I guess, your mum and dad then, I mean, yeah, when they were saying that to you, very few people compared to now had degrees.
Yes, I think that's probably also true.
It's very watered down now that most people seem to go to college.
Yeah, that needle's always moving. That seemed to be something that I noticed was right when I got into the corporate world. It was like, okay, a bachelor's degree is good.
Yeah.
But it's kind of like a high school degree.
If you really
want to distinguish yourself, go get a master's degree. So I did that. I went and got a master's degree. And I think it was worth it, but it also worked out that I had a profession where those kind of things mattered.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of cases where it's like, don't bother. For a while, I had considered pursuing a doctorate, but the experience of getting a master's degree cured me of that delirium.
Fair enough. I can imagine it would.
I got very sick of academia very quickly. And I mean, I didn't even have what I guess I would consider full scale academia. It wasn't like the way it exists in the Ivy League schools. Like I had a friend that went to Berkeley and he told me what it was like for him. And he had gone through to a master's degree program as well. And it just sounds like another scam. It sounds like another scam to me, the way it's all organized and the way they run it. It's a fucking scam. It's like health insurance. It's the same thing. I hate to say that because that degree that you get is still something that's of value. You can still go get yourself a job with it, right? But I wish the system that students had to swim through to get the degree wasn't so fucking corrupt. It's a real shame.
Yeah, it's a business, really. A sector.
Yeah, you turn it into a private business, and that's what they start going for is private revenue. Yeah. Well, that's an odd topic we just got onto.
I think just to cap it off, I think what I would say is if anyone is sort of, is listening to this and thinking about doing a degree, but they
fuck stay in school. Wanted profession, God damn it! I just thought
if they want to do something where if you want to be a doctor, you need a degree, right?
Yes.
If you want to be a writer, you don't need a degree. If you want to do a writing course, there's a good chance that you can get university materials through freedom of information requests. Yes. But don't even bother, because if you're working in a university, it means you as a professional failed.
That's just
acting teachers. Sorry.
It had just occurred to me that I said things that people are going to be able to listen to, and I thought, oh no, I've all the parents are going to be screaming at me. They had me recently. It was towards the end of the last year. They had me speaking to a classroom of students in New York. I was doing it over a session just like this. Okay. And Well, a lot of them were high school students, and I was just talking to them because they were interested in talking to a writer, right? Yeah. And
spelt with an O.
They ask you questions to test you and see if you're going to be truthful with them.
Who ask you questions?
The students. I was talking directly to the students. It was just like 1984, man. I was just this disembodied head on a TV talking to.
Oh, so you weren't actually there, right? I see.
No, yeah, I didn't fly over there. I didn't. The schedules didn't work out that I could do that. It was kind of a last minute thing anyway. But it's funny because they test you. They're trying to determine will this person tell you the truth. So they ask you questions like the one kid stood up and said, "Have you ever smoked weed before?"
I'm smoking it right now.
Like randomly, what does that have to do with anything? But you know, I wasn't going to lie to the kid.
No.
And well, no, I told him yes, I have done it before. Everybody's tried it once at least, right? And like right after I said that, I thought about it. Like, am I supposed to say that, or am I supposed to be just preaching? Stay away from the stuff. It got very strange. For me very quickly, because it kind of brought into focus, like, you're talking to impressionable kids here. Don't say something stupid, okay? So they would kind of ask questions like that, like, would you go to a college to learn to do these things? And I was honest with them. I told them kind of the same thing that we just said here. But it's really strange when you think you're saying something and somebody might actually listen to you. It's kind of scary.
Someone might, like, in 20 years, you know, when you're wearing your tuxedo and spats, some homeless person might shuffle towards you and say, "You told me to not go to college.
You said don't get a degree."
Yeah.
Yeah, that I think that's what probably scares me the most. Someone who wants to read my books and take something away from them, that's fine. But for God's sake, please don't listen to something that I say and think it means anything.
Yes, well, yes. I say this to you as George Rockelschmidt, not exactly super successful.
So, yeah, it's just a couple of dickheads.
Just a couple of dickheads. So take that for what it's worth, you know.
All right, I think this is good. I'm going to stop recording now.
Okay.
This has been a lot of fun.
Well, thanks very much, KSM, for letting me voice my displeasure of education amongst the youth.
Right.
So, yeah, see you next time.